show. Boise State, Bart Hendricks threw more touchdown passes than anyone else in Division 1A. Now he leads the nation's top scoring offense against Rocky Perez and the UTEP Miners. It's a showdown of gunslingers in the Humanitarian Bowl.
A crisp, cool day in Boise and warmed by a tailgate fire, fueled by pregame fare. Better than 30,000 will fill Bronco Stadium. Matter of fact, man and beast will be here to watch conference champions UTEP of the WAC and Boise State of the Big West as they meet on the blue turf. The Broncos are home for the holiday, while first-year head coach Gary Nord has the Miners at UTEP bowling for the first time in 12 years. The Crucial.com Humanitarian Bowl is next, but first, let's go to Chris Fowler and Rodney Gilmore.
Hendricks and Boise State set to battle UTEP when you come back.
Texas El Paso Miners meet the Boise State Broncos in the fourth annual Crucial.com Humanitarian Bowl. Boise State running back Brock Forsey, last year's Humanitarian Bowl MVP, accounting for 269 yards of offense against Louisville. He's back with his Broncos for another shot at postseason glory. Hi, everybody. I'm Wayne Larrabee, along with Randy Wright. Jim Barber will join us from the sidelines. Two high-scoring offenses. Matter of fact, Boise State led the nation in scoring in a spread-the-wealth kind of passing attack.
Well, Lupinuki leads this team with 40 receptions, but there are over five players with 20 receptions each, and all five of those players average over 15 yards per catch, so they get a lot of production from a lot of different guys.
Well, UTEP's targets downfield are fewer in number, but very effective, as you can see right here.
And maybe harder to defend. They're going to try and get the ball to their outstanding wide receiver, Lee Mays, and of course, their All-American tight end, Brian Natkin.
To the sidelines, Jim Barber with Boise State head coach Dirk Cutter. Jim?
Thank you, Wayne. Last dance for this man here at Boise State. Your words today to the players and your emotions as you prepare for the final game.
Well, we gotta take care of business, and I just told them to play like they can and play like they have for the last 2 years. If they do that, we'll be fine.
The field is slippery and it's cold. Might we still expect a high-octane game, a high-offensive game, as we had anticipated?
Well, we're going to go downtown as often as we can. Our players are used to this weather, and this is how we like it here. So we've got the inversion working, and the weather gods are smiling on the Broncos right now. I hope we can back it up.
Good luck in your final game here.
Thank you very much.
Guys, and in his final game at Oregon as an offensive coordinator, they lit up Air Force. We'll see if that happens today.
Take a look at the weather conditions here. It is a cool 33, very damp here with the inversion they talk about. Probably warmer up in the mountains than it is down here in the valley. The coin toss has just happened at the 50-yard line. UTEP won the toss, deferred its decision. And so we should be just about set. UTEP in the solid white with the orange trim, orange helmets, orange pants. Gary Nord, there he is, in his first season as UTEP head coach. He was the offensive coordinator here for 3 years and has led a revival of this program. And they are excited to be here from El Paso, Texas. Some of the fans as well. I'm sure it's a little warmer in El Paso this weekend than it is here in Boise, Idaho, but nonetheless, postseason is postseason, and they're looking forward to it.
When you talk about the weather being a little chilly, but there's not much wind at all, and as much as these teams throw the ball, wind could be a bigger factor than the actual temperature. They're going to warm up as they're out there playing.
And the fans, they're already warm. Quite used to it. Ricky Bishop, a senior out of El Paso, Texas, a left-footed kicker, pretty strong leg. We'll get set to kick it away for the Miners. Boise State in the home solid blue uniforms, blue helmets, red trim, white numbers. David Michael, first in the Big West, third nationally, kickoff return average is back deep. And we're just about set to go. Great to have you with us on this Holiday Bowl week on ESPN2. Ricky Bishop waiting for the okay from the officials, and we are just about set.
Come on,
underway. Pick hooks toward the far side. Here comes Michael. Couple of good moves out across the 35-yard line to the 36. Jeremy Castillo made the stop for Texas El Paso. Bart Hendricks, in his fifth and final season here at Boise State, responsible for 23 points a game. That leads the nation. And Boise State, good field position to start their opening drive off a 33-yard return. Hendricks from Reno, Nevada. That's Lou Finucci, the wide receiver in motion. Brock Forsey got the first call. No, good play action fake and a throw to Finucci. Well done to the 45-yard line of El Paso. Weldon Cooks made the stop. Take a look at the skill position people for Boise State. We talked a little bit about Finucci. Swilly and Poutier are also threats downfield. Chase Swan, a good blocker in the offensive backfield. And Forsey, the MVP of this game a year ago.
Offensive line, Matt Hill, the right tackle. Excellent athlete, great size. 6'6", 295 pounds.
First down at the 45-yard line of UTEP for Boise State. Just underway. Good protection for Hendricks. The ball tipped short of the mark, incomplete. Tipped by one of the linemen. That pocket a pretty tight one. We take a look at the UTEP defense, Randy.
Defensive line, Menson Holloway, the right defensive end, leads this team in tackles for loss and sacks at 10 and a half.
Trey Merkins is the second leading tackler in the WAC conference. And in the secondary, A.J. Shepard runs things in the middle. Clemens and Cooks, both all WAC consideration on the corners of this defense. They were a surprise this year. Second and 10. To Forsey. Plowing forward for about three to the 42-yard line, where it'll be third down coming up. D.J. Walker, second team all WAC, made the stop.
When you take a look at Brock Forsey there, and he's had an outstanding season, averaging 4.6 yards per carry, 197 rushing attempts. You hear a lot about Bart Hendricks and this passing offense, but Brock Forsey contributes with the ground game, and it's very, very effective.
First third down call for Bart Hendricks. Got a four wide receiver set. Forsey's the lone setback. Hendricks under some pressure, screens it out. Forsey's got some blocking. Good cutback runner. First down to the 28-yard line of El Paso. Trey Merkins made the stop.
You see one of the favorite pass plays that Bart Hendricks will run. It's the screen pass out to Forsey. You let the rush come upfield, and then he dumps the ball to the opposite side. Now, Forsey is one of their receivers that has over 20 receptions, and he's averaging 17 yards per catch. And for a running back to average that much yards is really an outstanding thing.
First down, football at the UTEP 28-yard line. That's Swilly, the man in motion. The fake to Forsey. Hendricks got a man wide open. Swilly, touchdown. Randy, you just can't say enough for the play fake ability of Bart Hendricks. He really sells it.
Well, he sells the run, and the fact that Brock Forsey does such a good job forces UTEP to come up and respect and try and stop that run. And when you have that kind of running attack and so many different receivers that can make big plays and get open, you can see why they've been so successful. Not much of a pass rush early. It lets Hendricks get back there, and Swilly just beats his man. The safeties come up. Swilly's wide open.
Nick Kalayakai. Boise State scored 66 points in each of its last two regular season games. They were wondering if they were still going to be able to hit on all cylinders a month later. Well, their first drive indicates they are on track.
You take a look at this graphic right here, and the offensive production for both teams. Boise State first in the nation in points, but yet UTEP averaging over 30, and both teams do a nice job on the ground to complement their passing attack. So if you're UTEP and you're sitting here, wow, we're down 7-0, they're saying, that's no big deal.
You're telling me 7 points is not going to win this game.
Seven points is not going to win this quarter.
So an outstanding opening drive for Boise State. Hendricks, 3 of 4, 62 yards, and of course the touchdown pass.
Wayne Dirk Cutter told us something very interesting yesterday when he said, when we throw the ball, we're not going to do this to try and get 5 yards. We're going to go downfield. If we're going to work hard to put something in and make it effective, we're going to make it worthwhile. We're throwing it downfield. I think we've seen a taste of what he means.
Brett Thompson, senior out of Mission Viejo, California, getting set to kick it away. Sanchez on the left side, and on the right side of your screen, Sam Singleton, and now we're set to go. Got a short kick, and it is Singleton from the 19. Stuck right away by Matt Strofus, a backup fullback. So it is first down at the 21-yard line for the University of Texas, El Paso. There's a look at Rocky Perez. He's had an up-and-down career, tough and resilient. He is the leader, the heart and soul of the revival of football on the campus of the University of Texas, El Paso. His brother, Mike, was a quarterback at UTEP back in the late 80s, early 90s, and has been an inspiration for Rocky. Snap, a tight end in motion. Robain Cleveland spilled out across the 25-yard line. Shenard Hart made the stop. Gain of about 5. Take a look at the skill position, folks, for UTEP. Natkin, we talked to him, and Lee Mays. Alan Ray, the other wide receiver. Cleveland got the stop. Start at the fullback.
Best offensive lineman, left guard Lawrence Norman, only 6'1", but they say he's all hips and all butt.
And if you're a left guard, that's probably a good thing to be. Second down, a little bit less than 5. Perez going over the top for Lee Mays, and the pass overthrown. Good coverage by D. Ross down the sideline for Boise State. Take a look at the defense for Boise State. On the line, Jeff Kopp and Zach Weber do a good job of funneling everything inside to Altieri and Phillips. In the linebacking core, they're relatively inexperienced in terms of playing time, but Sandoval was a starter last year. In the secondary, Dees and Ross are very good on the corner. Quentin Michael is the best player on this defense at free safety, co-defensive player of the year in the Big West. Third down for Rocky Perez and company. Option. Pitch is off the mark. Sherman Austin chases it down, but a loss of yardage back to the 16-yard line. A loss of about 11. Justin Howell got over to make the hit, but a shaky start for the Miners.
Little change up here with this play calling. Usually a passing down. Nice job by Perez, forcing the defense to commit, but then make the poor pitch, maybe that cold left hand. Hadn't used that left hand very much. You tend to blow on your right hand as a quarterback. That's your passing hand. So maybe a little bit of the weather having an effect on that play.
Quentin Michael, rarely fair catches. He is fearless back there. Glenn Beard's punt, kind of a line drive kick, but deep. And it gets a UTEP hop back inside the 25. Here comes Michael. Had to get through some friendly fire and is spilled at the 26. Boise State has the early advantage. They're coming back on the field offensively. They lead 7-0 over UTEP in the fourth annual.
ESPN2's exclusive presentation of the 2000 Crucial.com Humanitarian Bowl is presented by Crucial.com, the memory experts, and in part by Capital One. What's in your wallet?
Country here in Idaho. We're in Boise, Idaho, the capital of the state. First down for Boise State. That was one of those attitude runs. You just hand it to the back and you say it's attitude right at the defense for a yard or so. And we're happy to be here. And these folks, 30,000 plus on hand for this ball game. Broncos Stadium, it's a cool day. Dirk Cutter, his final game. He'll move down to Arizona State. Starting next year, actually, following this game, he and his staff will, 7 members of his staff from Boise State will head south, take over that program in the Pac-10. Second down. A little too hot and high for Swilly that time. And it'll be a third down coming up. A.J. Shepard had the coverage.
Not a great throw by Hendricks, but you could see how wide open Willie was. And that leads you to believe that these defensive backs for UTEP really giving a lot of room. They can't focus on one guy. A lot of them contribute. And sooner or later, they're going to get the matchup that they like. We've already seen it a couple of times. A lot of room those defensive backs are giving these receivers.
Third and nine. Good protection. Hendricks going for Swilly, and the pass sails out of play. Good coverage once again provided by A.J. Shepard.
One of the leaders in the defensive backfield for UTEP, A.J. Shepard, excellent coverage. Difficult route to cover also. The corner route, Willie comes down, goes to the outside, and Shepard never lets him get open. Stays with him the whole way. Nice anticipation. Hendricks had no place to put the ball.
Back near the line of scrimmage, a penalty marker was thrown, and it's against Boise State. We'll get the official call in a moment. Here it is.
Yeah, illegal formation against the offense. Not enough men on the line of scrimmage. That penalty is declined. Fourth down.
When we talk about that UTEP defense, and they only have three seniors out there. Now, those guys are big contributors. Menson Holloway in the defensive line. Trey Merkins, their linebacker. And Shepard, who we've talked about. Not a lot in numbers, but a lot in leadership.
Javier Sanchez had a punt return for a touchdown called back due to penalty at Tulsa. He averages 6.5 yards per return, and that's Jeff Edwards. First team all Big West punter, averaging 42 yards a kick with a long of 60 this season. Tom Anderson on the snap. Sanchez. Across the 40-yard line. Good return. Boise State has the early advantage. Bart Hendricks on a 28-yard touchdown strike to Swilly. And Hendricks reacts. We're back in the saddle again. Wayne Larrabee, Randy Wright, Jim Barber, welcome back to Boise, Broncos Stadium. Boise State leading 7-0. We have 11:07 to go. First quarter. The University of Texas El Paso Miners take over with a first down to the 41. Knapp in motion, Perez rolling that way. And overshot Napkin, the All-American tight end, who was open near the 45 of Boise State.
Take a look at Rocky Perez this time. A little play action, which just buys him a little more time. Not under a lot of pressure, and has a wide open Ryan Natkin. But I wouldn't be surprised to see what we are started to see. Rocky Perez starting a little slowly. He needs to be able to get into a rhythm. This is a big game for him, a bowl game right now. And this is his last game, a lot of excitement. He started a little slow. I expect him to pick it up pretty quickly here.
Not a lot there. As they go with Chris Porter, a fullback out of San Antonio, Texas. Second team all WAC. Weber and Phillips on the defensive line respond, along with Quinton Michael, who is all over the field. You'll see a lot of that young man, number 9, Quinton Michael, here today in the Boise State secondary.
That secondary, the strength of this Boise State defense, several players back there make big plays in the running game as well as the passing game, led by Quinton Michael, as you said.
Three receivers at the top of your screen. Third and 8. Perez. Able to thread the needle, but through the hands of the intended receiver. Michael had the coverage in front, may have screened Paul Tessier on the play. He was the man that Perez was trying to get the ball to.
Nice job by Perez coming off of his primary target and trying to pick up Tessier. Threw the ball just a little behind it, but an outstanding play by Michael. To the outside of the hash mark, reads the quarterback, comes in here, dives just to get that hand in there. Outstanding play.
Yeah, Michael tipped it away from the receiver. Didn't go through Tessier's hands. Never got to his hands. Glenn Beard's punt. Quinton Michael lets it go, and it caroms through the end zone. College football Football, second season in ESPN. Two great bowl matchups coming your way today. First at 4 o'clock Eastern, 1 Pacific, the Music City Bowl from Adelphia Coliseum in Nashville. The Ole Miss Rebels challenging the West Virginia Mountaineers. Don Neyland's last game at West Virginia, the longtime head coach. And then at 7:30 Eastern, 4:30 Pacific, wide receiver Antonio Bryant leads the Pitt Panthers to Bank One Ballpark in Phoenix, Arizona for the Insight.com Bowl. They'll be facing the Iowa State Cyclones in that ball game. Bryant, the Bolitnikoff Award winner. First down to the 20-yard line for Boise State. Late pressure and a quick move defensively. Sack made by Trey Merkins, blitzing up the middle from his middle linebacker spot.
You have to give a lot of credit to Weldon Cook, the defensive back. Nice coverage that time on Jace Willie. Forced Hendricks to hold on to the ball a little longer than he wanted to. When you only drop back three or four steps, you got to get rid of that ball quickly.
Loss of eight. Second and long. Merkins. Very active. They'll bring him from a number of different spots on the field. Forsey tried to cut that back. Nothing doing. Got maybe a yard out to the 13, depending on the spot of the ball. Kamar Jackson, Paul Smith collaborate on the stop for UTEP.
When you mentioned Kamar Jackson, one of their linebackers, Trey Merkins, the other linebacker. Merkins has really been the guy that has stepped up and done a great job. 112 tackles this year. Also second on the team in tackles for losses with 13. Kamar Jackson there also is another very strong season. Also, that's been a real positive for this defense.
No gain on the previous play. Third and long. Hendricks in the shotgun. Go for Finucci on the sidelines and a penalty marker down. Grant Clemens had the coverage near the 30.
Take a look and see if we can pick this up. Clemens on the outside has pretty good position and pretty good coverage. Not a lot of room. Boy, that's a pretty ticky-tack call for sure. That looked like pretty good coverage all the way there.
We have holding against the defense. The foul was against an eligible receiver. There's an automatic first down, 10-yard penalty from the previous spot. First down.
Well, the referee, Rogers Redding, with the call, and this drive remains alive for Boise State as a result of that penalty. Gary Nord, his first full season as head coach at UTEP. Not happy, obviously, with that call. I think he felt the same way you did about it, Randy.
I think you got to let him play, and I think that was pretty good coverage there. And if you're going to call it that tight, we're going to see a lot of flags today because both these teams are going to put the ball in the air a lot.
First and 10, football to the 22. Short drop by Hendricks, quick throw on the slam, hooks the air, fumbles football, scooped up by Swilly. Boise State football out near the midfield marker.
Here's a target that Hendricks likes to go to over the middle. He's got great size, 6'5", 135 pounds. Throws this ball in front of him so he can go up and get it. Then a nice hit there causes the fumble, but Twilly, the man right on the spot, picks that up.
Looks like the hit by DJ Walker. We're at Bronco Stadium, Boise, Idaho, for the Crucial.com Humanitarian Bowl. Wayne Larrabee, Randy Wright, Jim Barber, good to have you with us. Bart Hendricks on first down. He's got a man out there, Twilly, in the pass. A.J. Shepard! The Rattler in the secondary of the University of Texas, El Paso, with the interception. His second of the season.
Wayne, one of the few criticisms of Bart Hendricks, he doesn't throw the deep ball as well. This ball, well underthrown. Willie had a good 5 or 6 yards on the coverage, and Shepard comes back there and makes the interception. Now watch Hendricks lose his shoe right there.
That's his plant foot.
Wow. You see the slip there a little bit, and I think that probably had something to do, at least mentally, with the way that ball was thrown.
So does the first down for the Miners. Boise State's been turned back on its second and third offensive possessions of the day after scoring on their first possession. Not a whole lot there as the call goes to Chris Porter for a few. Jim Barber is with us on the sideline. Jim, how about the condition in that field? It looks like people are slipping around just a little bit down there.
Yeah, in fact, guys, they did some painting this morning on the logo and some of the signs here on the football field. That took place at 4 a.m., and the head coach at Boise State complained that it was rather slippery because of that painting. Really, the problem is the inversion here. Otherwise, that would have dried and we would have been okay. By the way, 4 a.m. wake up, that's pretty early for anybody.
Certainly much earlier than our crew. Here's Chris Porter. Again, UTEP, Randy, to me, looks like they're just trying to settle into this game. They gave up the touchdown of the first drive of the game to Boise State. They took the big shot. Defensively, they tightened things down a little bit, including the interception a moment ago. And now offensively, they just need to stay on the field and get into some kind of rhythm.
And I think they're going to try and put that pressure on the strength of this offense, which, as Gary Nord told us, is that offensive line. That's the bread and butter of it. That line has allowed Roxy Perez and Lee Mays and Brian Natchez to have the kind of year they have. Let's run the ball. Let them handle the pressure.
Joey Knapp, a tight end in motion. Perez had Knapp open and just did overshoot him. Rocky Perez has not been very accurate in the early going, Randy, and I wonder also about Rocky adapting to these conditions. Is it going to take him a couple of series to do that?
If you think about staying warm, it's going to take you a long time. If you think about playing the game, then you're going to get over it quickly, and I think it has affected at least his accuracy at this point. But he's had bad starts before and been able to overcome that and had outstanding games. And that's what needs to happen here. And quickly, as far as Gary Nord is concerned.
Line drive kick. Quentin Michael does not fair catch. To the 45. Good field position coming up for Boise State. Out to the 48-yard line. Well, the message being sent here today. This staff may be on its way out, but Boise State program is on the way up. Outgoing Boise State head coach Derek Cutter on how his team will react today after a month of coaching change and game inactivity.
That's the one unknown in this game, as I know UTEP is hungry and happy to be in a bowl game, and this is our second straight year in this bowl, and our coaching staff's last game. I'm nervous about that. Not nervous on a personal level, but just nervous about how our team that was pretty much hitting on all cylinders at the end of the year, you know, how this last month, all the things that have transpired, I don't know how that's going to affect 18 to 21-year-old guys. I don't know how it's going to affect me for sure, but I think that could be a factor today.
Dirk Cutter, as we mentioned before, he and seven members of his staff will be heading down to Arizona State. It's their next challenge.
It's hard enough to know how 18 and 21-year-olds are going to react to anything anyway, much less something as emotional as this team's gone through the last 30 days.
First down, 48-yard line. Excellent field position for Boise State to start this drive. Hendricks, under some late pressure, Brock Forsey was out there in the pass overthrown.
Nice job by Hendricks, standing in the pocket, feeling that pressure and getting the ball out and at least giving his receiver a chance. Pretty good protection early, but there comes the pressure late, and Forsey wide open down the field, and Hendricks pays for it, taking a hard hit on a cold day. That'll stay with you for a few plays.
Sure will. Again, that was Daniel Kerr getting in there on the pressure for UTEP. Second and 10. Willie, the man in motion, two tight ends on the line, and Brock Forsey gets the call. Hit that hole hard and picked up about 2 yards. Just barely into UTEP territory. Mid-portion of the defense was there to respond.
Wait, UTEP has a pretty solid defense against the run. It's a little surprising with what they're doing. They're only playing four linemen, two linebackers, nickel with five defensive backs the whole time. You wouldn't expect to get a lot of pressure on your quarterback or be real effective against the run, but it's something they've done all year, and when they've been successful, it's been because of Minson Holloway, their outstanding defensive end.
Now it's a third down and 8 for Boise State. Their fourth possession of the day. Hendricks. Minson Holloway brings up another sack, this one back at the 42-yard line. And it is fourth down. Randy, the coverage, that looked more like a coverage sack to me. It had to be pretty good in the secondary.
And I think we've seen that as this first quarter has progressed. Hendricks has not been able to get rid of the ball as quickly as he would like. Holloway that time just beats his man. And Kirk Cutter told us, we're going to have schemes to block them. We don't know if we can just hold up man-to-man.
Holloway's second sack of the afternoon. Jeff Edwards' punt. Javier Sanchez. Nice cutback move there. Gets it out across the 30-yard line. Wes Nurse, a linebacker, made the stop. Join ESPN Classic to celebrate college football's bowl season as today's powerhouse team square off for glory. Revisit the greatest games in the past. The 69 Rose Bowl. How about the 83 Sugar Bowl and the 94 Orange Bowl? Just some of these classic gridiron battles you'll see. The all-time best in college football, Saturday, noon Eastern, Sunday, 12:30, only on ESPN Classic. To order ESPN Classic, dial 1-800-CLASSIC or call your cable provider. First down. Chris Porter has found the sledding tough on the ground here today. Although the field may be a bit slick, the defense has been very aggressive. Gain of about 3. Take a look at UTEP's possession chart so far.
Well, they have struggled, as you can see, not a first down yet. And if Rocky Perez doesn't get on a roll quickly, this is what you're going to see throughout the game, because with this offense, he has got to be hot. He has got to be effective for this offense to move.
Naked gun, Perez in the shotgun. Make it a 4-receiver set. Jailbreak play, wide receiver screen, and they finally get Lee Mays involved, the junior out of Houston, Texas. Average 6.5 receptions per game. Bernard Hartz made the stop at the first down for UTEP.
Whenever your quarterback's struggling, give him something familiar, something he's got confidence in, something that's easy to throw. Get the ball to your best receiver. That's what they did right here. Pick up that first down. Now they have at least a little something they can work with.
First down to the 44-yard line. Perez with setbacks alongside in the shotgun. Everybody out for a pass. Ray at the first down marker. Did he get down in bounds? Yes, he did. Alan Ray on the reception, a gain of about 11 yards.
Best throw Rocky Perez has had today. The hardest throw, the quick out, but watch where he puts this ball. Perfect spot. Gives Ray a chance to catch it. Nice job getting his feet down. Nothing you could do to stop that play if you're a defensive back.
D. Ross had pretty good coverage on that play. Perez, 2 of 6, 21 yards passing, but Randy, I think you're right. He may be just warming up here in this first quarter. Blitz coming. They run away from it. Porter breaks the tackle of Wes Nurse and is angled out of bounds near the 41-yard line. Jim Barber, how is Rocky Perez staying warm on the sideline?
Well, he's using a very effective hand warmer and doing a lot of activity on the sidelines, Wayne and Randy. In fact, in addition to the hand warmer, we saw him throwing the football many times to a couple of receivers while Boise State was on offense. He seems to have no trouble gripping the football and, at least to this point, no trouble with the cold.
Jim, I played many a days in Green Bay, and if you think about staying warm, you're not gonna. You got to think about playing the game, and a little success that he will have will get his mind on that.
Four receiver set, single back offense. Perez rolling, coming back the other way. Good adjustment made by Knapp. Cannot rein it in at the 5-yard line. D. Ross had the coverage. They are not afraid, Randy, to go downfield to these tight ends. Joey Knapp, who's a good athlete, and Brian Natkin, who's an accomplished All-American tight end.
And they need to get those tight ends involved, and it is going to be downfield. They'll take advantage of the underneath stuff, but this is a big play offense, and Knapp doesn't get near the notoriety that a Brian Natkin does, but they think Knapp is actually a better athlete.
He's a junior out of Fort Worth, Texas, and 13th nationally for tight ends in reception. UTEP 0 for 3 on third down. That's Mays in motion. Blitz coming. Mays gets the first down. Oh, he's short of the first down. Great, sure tackle made by Sean Sandoval. They're about a yard short, but going for it.
Yeah, I think it's a good call. You got to go for it here. Nice catch by Mays, going in motion one way, gathers his feet, comes right back, and nice job catching that hard thrown ball by Perez. You can just see on this drive, Wayne, that Perez has a different step to him, a different attitude as he's throwing the ball right on target.
Fourth down, out of the eye, double tight ends on the line. Robain Cleveland fumbled the football. Quentin Michael, the recovery. Boise State going the other way. Out beyond the 45-yard line in Bronco territory. And Gary Nord frustrated with that turnover.
Well, he knows that you can't give an offense like Boise State too many opportunities. Nice job right there, getting the head in there, putting it right on the ball. And as a running back, you've got fourth and one. You obviously think about picking up the first, but you got to hold on to the ball.
What's
a nice defensive stand, defensive play right there by Zach Weber.
Yep. Zach Weber triggered it loose. Football recovered it. Bart Hendricks is back in business. Football it is. Hendricks running option, teaching. Not going anywhere.
Hofer, the defensive coordinator for UTEP, had told us he plays this style of defense because he wants speed on the field. Five defensive backs, smaller linebackers, get to the play, and I have been very impressed with the way their defense has pursued and really beat the running backs before you stay to the hole.
Certainly, UTEP has held its own and then some in the trenches here. Second down, about 12 yards to go. Hendricks off the play fake. Screens it out. Tim Gilligan. Into UTEP territory to the minor 41-yard line. Gilligan, a little used wide receiver, a freshman out of Elko, Nevada. Sam Singleton made the stop.
Often you see the quarterback go back, fake a reverse to a receiver. The defense forgets about him. Gilligan just continues around. He's just a drop-off if it's covered downfield. Hendricks had it in the mind and turned out to be a nice play.
First down at the 39-yard line, just inside the 40. Jace Willie in motion. Hendricks, maybe a broken play. I don't know. Really open. If that was a broken play, it was well designed. Tell you what, and a great throw by Bart Hendricks. Weldon Cooks was there defensively to force him out of play, along with the linebacker Paul Smith.
Not sure how much of a broken play it was. It's just an outstanding play action fake right there. Pulls the defense, and Willie comes across wide open. And Willie, more than anybody else, has been the wideout that stood out today. Take a look at Hendricks. We've seen him get hit a couple of different times. We talked about the questionable hit. That was very questionable as being a late hit.
22-yard gain. Rushes on again. Swilly makes the catch for that play. Well defense. They came in with the blitz from Trey Merkins. Swilly the reception, and he was wrapped up immediately on the play. A.J. Shepard was there. Josh Randolph also in on the tackle.
A play we've seen become much more popular in college ball, the bubble screen, the jailbreak, as you refer to it. A.J. Shepard, nice job recognizing that early and getting inside.
Loss of three on the play. Boise State inside the 20 has been unbelievable this season.
56 times the number of opportunities stands out.
Hendricks. Sack for the third time today. Rick Fetty was there. But the principal defenders on the play, Daniel Kerr, the defensive tackle, and also Gabe Williams.
He's been an offensive line for Boise State. They've been pretty solid all year, giving up only 27 sacks. But that's not a lot when you've thrown the ball 372 times. But Hendricks has been under a lot of pressure, and as you said already, a couple of sacks and quite a few hits.
Third and long facing Boise State. And while the University of Texas El Paso offense has struggled to get on track, after giving up a touchdown drive on the first possession of the game, the UTEP defense has asserted itself for the most part here in the remaining stages of the first quarter. And as we turn the page to the second quarter, Boise State leads it by the score of 7-0 as, again, the UTEP defense appears to have adjusted and made things tough. Yeah, the Miners are in enemy territory, but nonetheless, Now, there have been some resounding hits in this game so far. Welcome back to the Crucial.com Humanitarian Bowl, the Mesa Falls, part of the beautiful countryside in this wonderful state of Idaho. There's more here than just potatoes, Randy, I want to tell you. Some great scenery.
Skiing we saw, some beautiful wildlife, and it's great to be out here. They treat you so well, the people are so friendly. It's great to be able to come out here and watch a great game.
Boise State just one of three on third down conversions, facing third and long here. Hendricks on a short drop. Nobody home. Banks, the intended receiver, or so it appeared, he was well covered by Trance Clemens.
I think what we've seen is you've heard so much about these offenses and the points they put up and the yards they put up. I think these two defenses got a little tired of hearing about that. And other than that first drive, the one big play, the defenses have been pretty solid.
Nick Kalaikai coming on for a field goal try. 42-yard field goal attempt. There's only one miss this year, and he gets this one on its way, and it is good. Kalaikai with a 42-yard field goal. Adds to the windfall for Dirk Cutter, and Boise State has a 10-0 lead early in the second quarter. Well, tomorrow is chock full of college football bowl action on ESPN. Coverage begins at 1:30 Eastern with the AXA Liberty Bowl. 22nd-ranked Colorado State against 23rd-ranked Louisville. From the Liberty Bowl, Memphis, Tennessee, then at 5 p.m. Eastern time. Chick-fil-A Peach Bowl. Nick Saban leads the LSU Tigers to their first bowl since 1997, challenging 17th-ranked Georgia Tech Yellow Jackets from the Georgia Dome in Atlanta. Cap off the triple-header at 8 Eastern with the 2000 Pelican Holiday Bowl as a major Applewhite and a 12th-ranked Texas match up against Joey Hamilton and the 11th-ranked Oregon Ducks from the Qualcomm Stadium in San Diego. There are the Texas quarterbacks. We understand that Chris Sims will get the start in that ball game.
Well, how'd you like to have those two quarterbacks on the same team? They could be starting for a lot of other teams, whatever it would be.
Yes, indeed. UTEP, a team that averaged 32 points a game this season, held scoreless for the first time through the first quarter this season. Brett Thompson on the kickoff. Good leverage into this kick. Sam Singleton. Short of the 20-yard line, stormed back. Brian Brinkley, a safety. Travis Berger in on the stop for Boise State.
With as ineffective as UTEP's offense has been, you did sense they were getting into a little more of a rhythm the last drive, and Boise State offensively hasn't really taken advantage of that very much. They're used to coming on the field, putting the ball in the end zone, and leaving, averaging 45 points a game. You know that UTEP is going to get on a roll and going to put some points on the board. Boise State, on the other hand, has got to get back into their rhythm because they haven't taken advantage of some of those opportunities.
First quarter, UTEP 16 plays, 30 yards of offense, 26 through the air, 8 on the ground. First down, football to the 17. Rocky Perez, good protection. And he's got Lee Mays dancing out of bounds across the 30 near the 33-yard line. Beat the coverage of D. Ross to the near sideline.
Rocky Perez completes his pass to number 7, Lee Mays.
Any successful passing attack has to start with protection. Perez has taken care of pretty well, at least enough time to get the ball off before Altieri got in there. You take a look at what this team has done all year. 406 yards of total offense, only 46 so far.
16-yard gain on that play. First down to the 33-yard line for the Miners. Joey Knapp, the man in motion. Chris Porter picking his way. Out across the 40 to the 41-yard line. It's a gain of about 8 yards. Greg Snesser, the active strong safety, a junior out of Salem, Oregon, made the stop.
UTEP has a running game by committee. Four different backs are very active, get involved, carry the ball. Mostly their ball carrying comes out of the fullback position, whether it's Chris Porter or Rovan Cleveland. They do give it to their tailback. Pretty equal fullback for a little bit.
Three receivers, top of your screen. That's Knapp in motion. Again, Porter. Tough yard there to the 42-yard line. Good portion of that Boise State defense has done a good job against the run. Jeff Kopp, the defensive end, collapsed on the play. Tony Altieri was also there, and he lost his foot shoe on the play. Not only did he lose his footing, he lost his shoe.
Maybe one because of the other.
Yes, could be. It's a little slick out there on the blue turf. The blue turf is frozen. I'm not going to call it frozen tundra, but it's frozen turf nonetheless. Third and one, UTEP. Roban Cleveland going wide. I don't think you. It depends on the spot of the ball, but it looks like they'll give him a favorable spot. He's close to the first down. Less than a yard away. Play was well strung out. Sandoval and Bart for Boise State.
Boy, it was very well strung out. It looked as though Cleveland was going to have an alley to cut up, but you look at those blue jerseys just pushing those white jerseys backwards, and it, what you found out is you had too many people in too small an area, and nobody could really get any leverage, and I think he's going to be short here.
Looks like it from where they've spotted it. They're calling for the change from across the way.
Well, this offense needs to get some first downs.
Yeah.
They need to give their defense a rest because those defensive backs are going to get tired continuing to chase those receivers around, and they need to give that defense a break, and they need a first down, and I think they did pick it up right here.
They did. By the nose of the football, they get a first down.
Well, it was close, but all the same, gives them another set of downs here.
Minor offense, as we pointed out, averaging over 400 yards a game, 32.3 points a game. That's 22nd nationally. Top 400 yards in offense in 12 of their last 16 games dating back to last year.
What they do, Wayne, they don't put a lot of substitutes in. They use a lot of different formations, but they keep the same people on the field.
Well, that makes it tough on the defense to match up personnel-wise. Pass under shot, Knapp, the intended receiver. Good pressure, Shenard Hartz. Weber got into the neutral zone quickly as well. I thought flag might be thrown, but I see no laundry on the field. So it'll be 2nd and 10 coming up for Utah.
Finish that point, Wayne. It's exactly what it does. It makes it hard for the defense to know who's going to be lined up where, and you can get some mismatches. Now, UTEP can take advantage of that because they've got some outstanding athletes, mostly in their tight ends with Brian Napkin and Joey Knapp. That allows them to use those guys as wide receivers and run those types of routes.
I beg your pardon, I said UTEP on the field offensively. Perez 4 of 10, 41 yards passing today. 2nd and 10 out of the shotgun. Quick throw to the sideline. Napkin, the tight end, stayed in bounds and a nice move to get the first down. A gain of 10 yards into Boise State territory. He had to dance around Dempsey Dees.
Boy, do the coaches love to talk about Ryan Napkin. The fact that he's just a tough, hard-nosed player. He plays to win. He's more committed to win than maybe anybody on their team. He's got excellent hands. Not great speed, but what speed he has, he uses very effectively, and he gets himself open. And when you've got a tight end that's a good blocker that gets open with great hands, you got the whole package.
Ian Perez came to El Paso from San Antonio together 5 years ago. Roban Cleveland hit at the point of attack and then twisted down as he tried to spill that to the outside. Zach Weber in the middle of the fray, others involved as well as LeGarry Mitchell, the linebacker, filled in. This is the Crucial.com Humanitarian Bowl. UTEP and Boise State. We're at Bronco Stadium in Boise, Idaho. I'm Wayne Larrabee alongside Randy Wright. Jim Barber is patrolling the sidelines in a stylish chapeau, I might add. Today. You notice that?
I did.
Wanted to make sure you were observant. 2nd and 10. Shotgun formation. 4 receivers set. Make it 5. Perez, Napkin uncovers, rudely ushered out of bounds at the 40-yard line by Shenard Hartz.
When you take a look at why it's been tough going for this UTEP offense, it's affected everywhere. You take a look at the hit that Perez faced in the passing game. Nice play by Michael in the backfield, and then the fumble on 4th down there. So whether they're trying to throw the ball or trying to run it, Boise State's really shut down.
UTEP facing 3rd down. Almost 4 yards to go. They're just 1 of 5 on 3rd down. There's the comeback screen to the tight end. Napkin breaks the tackle and down to the 25-yard line. Brian Napkin on a 15-yard gain, and Dempsey Dees, along with Quentin Michael, collaborate on the stop.
When we talked about their different personnel groups, we saw this play before with Mays lined up out there. This time we see Natkin in the wide receiver position. That brings a different defensive personnel group there, and yet UTEP can take advantage of it, make the big play out of it.
The consensus All-American, there he is, 64 receptions, and he is a go-to receiver for Rocky Perez. From the 25 on first and 10. Sherman Austin never got started. Of the running backs for UTEP, and they're running back by committee, Sherman Austin perhaps has the best speed or quickness, but he never got started.
Well, I think in order to use that speed, as you said, you've got to be able to get going. He's also the one back that's really starting to learn the role. Great speed. He was a wide receiver. He's just learning some of the blocking schemes in the passing game. They think he's got an excellent future.
Zach Weber is having an outstanding game along the Boise front line. He blew up that play for a loss of one. Second and 11 for Perez and company. Out of the shotgun. Beautiful play. Dempsey D tips it away from Lee Mays inside the 20-yard line.
Dempsey Dees is the best of the defensive backs for this Boise State team, especially in pass coverage. And he led this conference in interceptions as a sophomore and junior, and wisely teams threw away from him a lot this year. But look at that anticipation. Boy, you just can't play that any better. Wow. And that's going against a pretty good receiver.
He's going against an NFL caliber receiver someday. I expect to see Lee Mays with the NFL. Take a look at this drive. They motored 56 yards. Facing third and long. Perez got a good block on the flank. Trying to thread the needle. Quentin Michael knocks it away from Lee Mays at the 20-yard line. There's a penalty marker thrown late. I'm not sure if Michael may have put a hand into the back of the receiver. That could be the call we get here. But a play similar to what we saw a moment ago on the sideline, where Dempsey Dees was able to reach in front, knock the ball away. Here's the call. Holding against Boise State. So this is the first down for UTEP. And the football moves to the 16-yard line. 10-yard penalty.
Often when you see a quarterback rolling one way and the receiver going the other way, that defense feels that receiver's getting away from him because their eyes are in the backfield, and that can induce a holding penalty and a big play right there for UTEP.
UTEP, not bad inside the 20 at all. 71% touchdown. I think you'll take that.
I take that anywhere.
First and 10 of the 16. Chris Porter, tough yard. Zach Weber at his ankles would not let go. Wow, is he playing well here today. A senior in his final game at Boise State out of Gardnerville, Nevada.
It's his first year as a starter, and when you're playing your 12th game, you're not really a rookie at that position, but as you said, he's had a solid season, but he's playing an outstanding game early here. Forced the one fumble, already a couple tackles for losses. And that's one reason why UTEP has had a hard time getting that running game going.
Second and 9. Two tight ends on the line for UTEP. Short drop, Perez, quick throw. Alan Ray stacked up where he caught the ball to the 9-yard line. D. Ross was there along with Shenard Hart. It'll be a third down coming up, about 3 yards to go.
Wayne, when you're going to put this many men on the line of scrimmage, you've got to have closer coverage on the outside. Look at all these guys up here, but look at where he is. All that room out there makes it an easy throw for that quarterback to get that ball out there to him, and that's a pretty easy 6-7 yards.
Third down, a little bit less than 4 yards to go. This is the longest drive of the afternoon thus far for UTEP. Rocky Perez saw something he didn't like, perhaps the play clock winding down, and he called for a timeout. Early going, a second quarter in Boise. The homestanding Broncos lead by 10.
You are a cyber duck.
him.
That's pretty easy to do.
Yeah. Enjoy coming out here to Boise, the wonderful folks of Idaho. Rocky Perez, take a look at him. Remember, he started the game 0 for 4 and since has heated up.
I think he got a little upset with that start, and he's taking it out on Boise State.
Deepest penetration of the game for the Niner offense. Third down, just inside the 10. Everybody out for a pass. Got a man uncovered. Touchdown! Joey Knapp, his fifth touchdown reception of the season, a 9-yarder.
Wayne, there's a flag down, and it's going to be interesting to see if they call Lee Mays for offensive interference. No, they're not. They're going to call it against Boise State. But it was an excellent job of Perez getting the ball to Knapp, and then Lee Mays, from his wide receiver position, does a nice job blocking, gives Knapp the end zone.
So the penalty turned down. Let's see if we can pick it up.
Take a look at how quickly Perez gets rid of this ball, knows where his open receiver's going to be, and watch Mays right there as he's coming into your screen, screen off the defender, which allows Knapp to go in untouched.
So UTEP on the board. Ricky Bishop, left-footed kicker for the point after. And we've got ourselves a ball game. Rocky Perez starting to catch a rhythm. Joey Knapp uncovers in the red zone again, and UTEP back in it. Boise State's 10-0 lead has been sliced to 3 on the touchdown drive by the University of Texas El Paso. 9:26 to go first half. There is the 15-play scoring drive. Remember, in the first quarter, Randy, they ran just 16 offensive plays the entire quarter.
Well, you don't make any first downs, you're not going to get many plays.
When safety's back deep, David Michael, number 30, is the guy they'd like to get the ball into his hands. And here's the kickoff by Ricky Bishop. Michael takes it to the 6. Nowhere to go. He's upended immediately by Paul Smith. On the sideline, Jim Barber standing by with a special guest. Jim?
And Wayne, that special guest is Fred Waddell of Crucial.com.
Technical difficulties with the microphone down there. We'll get that straightened out and get back to Jim and Fred.
Big drive here for Boise State offensively. They haven't been able to move the ball as well as they did early. Bart Hendricks has had a couple of open receivers that he hasn't been able to hit, and hence they've only got that 3-point lead. You sense the momentum starting to change as UTEP is getting a little more familiar with these conditions, and Boise State has got to start putting that back in their favor.
Boise State scored on its opening drive, scored a touchdown with a field goal later. Brock Forsey on the 3. They run it with Forsey in the slot to start the play. They run him across the formation, and he picks up yardage for a first down. Trey Merkin did chase him down across the 25 near the 28-yard line. 15-yard gain.
Take a look at the blockers out in front of Forsey. Now remember, he's coming full speed when he gets that ball. Everybody else is starting from a dead stop. So he's got that advantage, and he uses that speed to turn that corner.
I don't know what his time is in the 40, Randy, but I think he has pretty good quicks.
It's fast.
He has pretty good quicks for sure. There's Forsey again in motion, and again they hand it to him. This time he cuts it back. Wise decision there. He saw the outside flank pretty well covered. And the tackle made by Tim Woodard at safety.
No, Wayne, the point you were just making, I think, is an excellent point. We saw it right here. Same type of play. He's running full speed, coming across, gets the handoff. There's nothing open to the outside, so he uses those quick feet to stop and turn it up and still turns it into a 5-yard gain.
Gain of 5 on that play. 2nd and 5 now for Boise State. Trying to settle down offensively here. And they did it with a couple of running plays. Now Hendricks to the air, being pressured. Got it away to Quill, broken up nicely. In the secondary, A.J. Shepard, the man who knocked it away. Pressure provided on the flank of that play by Kamar Jackson.
Nice job by Bart Hendricks. Thinking he had to scramble early, pressure breaks down. He brings it down, but then he gets his feet set, and he just throws it right to Chase Crowley. Take a look at this ball, right in the hand. Well, he's just taking his eyes off of it early, but he can't throw it any better.
Benson Holloway was in on that play very early once again. Boy,
if there's pressure on Bart Hendricks, chances are it's going to be missing all
number 58, yeah, in the orange number, white shirt. Third down. Quarterback draw. Right into the teeth of the defense, and they took a bite out of them.
Sometimes you just guess right defensively. They had an all-out blitz coming. They brought the corners from the outside. They brought the linebackers up the middle, and there was just too many people to block. Hendricks just takes the one step back, and that play had no chance of succeeding.
A.J. Shepard in on that play along with the Merkins.
Well, you have called his name a lot.
Yes, indeed. With reason. Jeff Edwards in punt formation just did get that one away. Take the Boise State hop and is well covered and out of bounds at Karen near the 25-yard line. UTEP offense got on track on their last drive, but defensively, this team from the Sun Bowl has come here to play in the person of A.J. Shepard leading the way for the secondary.
Miners ready to go on offense, trailing by three. Jim Barb with Fred Waddell, who's the general manager of Crucial.com, the major sponsor here of the Humanitarian Bowl. And Fred is from Boise, Idaho. Works out perfectly. Your company doing quite well with the association with this game.
We are. It's been great. We're a local company that you mentioned, part of the largest private employer, Micro Technology. It's a great way for us to reach a national audience as well as support a hometown institution.
You've seen the games here in the past, the Humanitarian Bowl. You think they match up pretty well with other bowl games across the country?
I think so. I think the last 3 years, if you look at it, this has been the most competitive game of all the bowls going back. And it looks like we got another barn burner going right now.
All right, Fred, we appreciate your time and thank you for joining us.
Thanks a lot.
You can tell Fred's one of the natives, too, because he's able to handle the cold, guys.
Lee Mays on a spectacular reception, beating Dempsey Dees over the middle, and it's first down for UTEP at the 38-yard line.
Well, take a look at where it starts, Wayne, with this protection. Rocky Perez can stand back there, throws a nice strike, but watch Mays concentrate on that ball, doesn't give up on it, and makes a big play. When UTEP got their game players, their game makers involved, Perez, Natkin, they started having success.
37-yard pass play. This one knocked down as he was trying to hit Natkin on the comeback route out of the bubble screen. Shenard Hartz got a piece of it.
What Shenard Hartz coming off of his corner on a blitz. Not that unusual. He led the conference in sacks this year with 7. So he's used to that position. And they tell you if you can't get to the quarterback, get your hands up and at least knock it down.
Second and 10. UTEP at the Boise State 37-yard line. There's a motion blitz coming. Good call up the middle. The fullback crashing forward fumbled the football, but the play had been whistled dead. Lee Mays recovered it anyway. Chris Porter on the carry. Close to a first down. In fact, he's got it, it looks like, near the 27-yard line. This will be a gain of about 10 yards.
What a nice job, first of all, by the offensive line clearing the hole, and secondly, by Chris Porter letting the play develop, having the patience to sit back there, let the block take effect.
We have offside against the defense. That penalty is declined. The result of the play is a first down. First down.
They were crowding the line. Watch it.
Take a look, see if we can see the offside right there. And then watch that blocking, and Porter sits back there, lets the blocking take effect, runs right behind the trap. Once he gets past the line of scrimmage, then he just gets into the secondary. Unfortunately, they roll that ball down.
Jeff Kopp, the guilty party on the penalty a moment ago, violating the neutral zone, but all for naught, first down for UTEP. Porter up the middle, running the defense inside the 15-yard line. West Nurse helped to bring him down. Zach Weber got a piece of him. 14-yard gain to a first down for the University of Texas, El Paso.
Take a look at the left side of the line. They pull right now, and look at that hole. You break the arm tackle, but once you get by that, then there's just plenty of room, and a back as big as 40, you're not going to be able to bring him down.
Boy,
with
he
tackle.
Followed Joey Knapp, a tight end up the middle. Knapp making like a fullback with that 30 on his jersey. He looked the part, and boy, did he execute on the blocking up punt. First down. Perez, touch pass, lead Mays. They love to go to Mays on the fade into the corner. Obviously well scouted by Boise State, as Dempsey Dees, the all Big West cornerback, had excellent coverage on the play. Shenard Hart's in the vicinity as well.
The play started right at the snap where Dempsey Dees forces Mays to the sideline. You see here, he's got no room to go up. In fact, he's already out of bounds. So when you get good position early, it really doesn't make much difference what the receiver does late in the play.
Second and 10. That's Joey Knapp in motion. Let's see if Porter follows him. Not quite, but Porter up the middle for a tough yard or two near the 11-yard line.
So often, Wayne, when you throw the ball on first down and it's incomplete, you're going to go back to a run on second down because you don't want to risk that third and 10. Unfortunately for UTEP, they didn't get anything on second down or even 1 yard, so now they do have that third long, and it's going to be a little harder to get the ball in the end zone because this is where Boise State likes to bring the extra defensive back and blitz and try and get to the quarterback.
Chris Porter, leading rusher on this team, over 680 yards.
Doesn't sound like a lot of yards, but when you look at the fact it's almost 5 yards per carry, pretty impressive.
Timeout called, 5:16 left to go in this first half on the blue field of Boise State. Broncos lead by three. Boise State leading 10-7. We're better than halfway through this first half. These two teams have combined for just 17 points. They average between them 77 points a game, Randy. So we're way off pace, but we're maybe in for some scoring down the road.
I don't think they're done yet.
No, I don't think so. I'd be shocked if 10 points wins this game. UTEP has made its last three third down conversion. Third and 9, Rocky Perez. Over the middle. Knapp to the end zone. Touchdown! Joey Knapp's second touchdown of the day. There is a penalty marker thrown in the offensive backfield. And they may be calling him back. Indeed, they are.
Well, Boise State came with an all-out blitz that time, and it looked as though UTEP had picked it up. May have been a holding caught up in that wash of jerseys there, too.
They have an illegal motion against the offense. 5-yard penalty, still third down.
Take a look right there. Take a look at this one right here. See if he moves early as the ball is ready to be snapped. Yeah, it looks like both of the backs actually jump a little bit early right there. So you could have called it on either one of them. And you know, when you're in the shotgun, the guys next to the quarterback are one of the only ones that can hear the quarterback. So they jump when they hear it. Takes the center a little bit longer.
Naked backfield. Five receivers set. Quick toss. Lee Mays on the wide receiver screen. Excellent tackle made by Shenard Hart. The extra safety that plays in the base defense for Boise State. Dempsey Dees is also there, and they snuffed it out pretty well. A relatively short game.
You take a look right there. Brent Guy, the defensive coordinator for Boise State. He's got his work cut out for him right now. He realizes that this UTEP team has started to get this running game going, which is going to make that passing game
exactly that
much harder to stop.
That has to be very concerning to Brent Guy. 29-yard field goal attempt. Ricky Fisher. John Dornbuck on the snap. Rocky Perez the holder. The kick on its way. And it is good. So we are tied with a little over 4 minutes to go in this first half. Coming up Sunday on ESPN, there's more college football bowl action to be had. It's the Sanford Independence Bowl from Independence Stadium, Shreveport, Louisiana. Mississippi State, led by quarterback Wayne Matkin, challenging Texas A&M, the Aggies. In from the Big 12, kickoff of this contest, 8 o'clock Eastern on ESPN. Bulldogs and Aggies, Sanford Independence Bowl, Sunday, 8 Eastern on ESPN. For more information, log on to ESPN.com.
Wayne, those are the same Aggies that this UTEP team played earlier in the year and were ahead of in the second half there. So UTEP comes in here 8-3 but yet their three losses on the road to three nationally ranked teams.
Well, they started in the 110-degree heat of Norman, Oklahoma, against the soon-to-be number one ranked Sooners, and as you mentioned, lost to Texas A&M and lost at TCU to LaDainian Tomlinson and Texas Christian University.
Take a look at that drive right there. Eight plays, getting into that rhythm. Almost 3.5 minutes. Ended on the field goal because the touchdown was called back, and unfortunately for UTEP, that penalty on that touchdown really didn't affect the play.
Michael Mupsit covers it across the 20-yard line near the 23, and it's going to be Boise State football.
Cowboy!
You know, some extracurricular pushing and shoving going on. They fight for the football.
You can sense the intensity has picked up on the field. And here, if you watch Michael just take his eyes off of it early, right in the old breadbasket, and fortunate to get this ball back, wisely just jumped on it at the end instead of trying to pick it up. When you take a look at Boise, they got plenty of time with this style of offense, but they've got to do something to get their confidence back because UTEP's done a nice job in the second quarter taking that away.
Boise State scored a touchdown on his first drive. Only a field goal since. Bart Hendricks going down for the fifth time, for the third time, at the hand of Minson Holloway, who was putting on a show on the defensive front. And Dirk Cutter talked about it. They might have to do something special to contend with him. They may have to add a back over there or a tight end on Minson Holloway. Crucial.com Humanitarian Bowl in Boise, Idaho, UTEP, and Boise State at Bronco Stadium. Don't adjust your set. That is a blue field you're seeing there. Wayne Larrabee, Randy Wright, Jim Barber. Coming up at halftime, preview of the Music City Bowl, the Insight.com Bowl, and more. Tough catch in traffic out near the 25-yard line. It's a gain of about 7 yards.
I mean, one thing UTEP has done defensively, they've really tightened up their coverage with their secondary. That forced Hendricks to hold on to the ball a little bit more, plus it's taken away the run after the catch. There you see really pretty good coverage there by Weldon Cook. Even though the ball is complete, it's only a 7-yard gain, which isn't bad when you've got 15 or 16 to go.
Lou Finucci, the receiver on that play, the leading receiver for Boise State, has been quiet here today. Hendricks. A.J. Shepherd, they brought the safety once again, and the Rattler gets to the quarterback. And right now, Boise State's offensive front is being totally outplayed by the defensive front seven and then some of UTEP.
Well, and then some, and some of that is not just the front five for Boise State. That blitz came right at Bart Hendricks. He had to be staring it down, should have just thrown the ball away instead of trying to outrun a defensive back.
Jeff Edwards kick, gets a Boise State hop. Sanchez makes the first man miss, and now cuts it back. Still on his feet across the 50. UTEP will start at the 45-yard line of Boise State. Well, the Miners are on track and feeling very much at home in these 30-degree temperatures. Let's go back to the studio, Chris Fowler. Chris?
Well, Wayne, I'm not sure what the buildup was like there in Boise, but in New Orleans, the Hurricanes and the Gators are getting after it. At halftime, we'll hear from coaches Spurrier and Davis. We'll also preview the Pittsburgh-Iowa State games and Ole Miss, West Virginia, as Rod Gilmore joins me at the half. Back to you.
So it's first down. Thank you, Chris. We'll look forward to that coming up at halftime. First down for the University of Texas El Paso, the 45-yard line. Their last two drives have resulted in a touchdown and a field goal, and they are right back in it, tied at 10 apiece. Rocky Perez to the sideline, intercepted by Boise State, Quentin Michael.
Oh, a ball that Rocky Perez knows he never should have thrown. You can't throw the ball late over the middle, and you can't throw it late to the sideline. So the point is, you can't throw it late anywhere. And as he was standing back there, he stared it down, was off balance. As you see, right there is when you need to throw it. As you're looking that way to try and throw it that far across the field, that's just asking for trouble, and Rocky Perez knows that. With his experience, he knows he just made a bad decision.
Tried to thread the needle to Lee Mays. And it's first down going the other way. Maybe that's the spark that Bart Hendricks and company and his struggling offense have needed since the early going of this ball game. Hendricks on option. Brock Forsey, boy, they have defended everything very well. Well prepared is this minor defense. Holloway initially and A.J. Shepard put the kibosh on that play. A loss of yardage back near the 40-yard line.
Boy, but that well defended. Nobody had a chance in this game. Hendricks was covered. He had the pitch. When you get the ball to Forsey, a couple of guys out there. Very nice defensive play.
A loss of about three. Second down.
Boise State's not going to rush to get things done here. They're going to let this clock go down now that they lost yardage on first down.
Hendricks screens it out. Brock Forsey with some blocking. To the 50, to the 45. First down and more, down to the 40-yard line. Weldon Cook, E.J. Walker on the play. First down for Boise State, one of their biggest plays since the early going of this game.
And Wayne, we talked about it earlier. When you're struggling, go back to a play you've got confidence in and one that you know you run well. That's the screen play. That's why Forsey's had so much success as a receiver this year. It's a high percentage pass, and that time it turned out to make a key first down.
18-yard gain, first down to the 40-yard line of UTEP. Hendricks. Willie, who caught the first touchdown pass of the game, gets about 3 or 4 yards here. Tim Woodard made the stop. 38 seconds left to go in this first half. Boise State starting to drive for the first time in a while. The timeout situation, two for Boise State, one for UTEP, as we reach the final minute of play in the first half. And UTEP coach Gary Nord pacing anxiously. His defense has carried the day for him here today. Well, the offense took a long time to get on track. There's the timeout situation. Boise State at the 37-yard line of UTEP. Willie in motion. Blitz coming. Hendricks swings it out to Brock Forsey. Got some blocking once again. A well-executed screen. Forsey, good cutback move, and then to the outside to escape out of bounds near the 21-yard line. First down coming up for the Broncos.
Boy, that play was really set up by Bart Hendricks. How he fades away from the side he's going to throw it to. Watch as he goes back. He'll go to his right, drawing the defense over there, and then he puts the ball out in Forsey's hands early enough. And watch how Forsey sets up his blockers. Weaves to the inside, back to the outside. Really does a nice job of finding that opening and turns that again with a simple little pass play into a huge game.
Well, they got 18 on the start of the drive when they called that play. They got 16 on that particular try. And now their first down just outside the 20-yard line of UTEP. From the shotgun, quick throw. And he threads the needle inside the 15-yard line. Catch made by Poutier. Walker had it, the coverage for UTEP, and they're about a yard short, maybe two of the first down.
Well, the best way to stop a good pass rush is to throw screens and to throw quick rhythm passes. This time, a lot of cushion that time by the secondary, and he can get the ball to his man quickly. Now, it doesn't need to be a big game when you start on your own 20-yard line. You just get right down there, so every yard being that much more valuable.
Well, you know, this UTEP program, the seniors in this program have seen quite a turnaround, and head coach Gary Nord talked about it and their impact to the program.
Well, it means a lot. 2 years ago, we had the longest losing streak, or the second longest losing streak in the country, and they're about three-quarters of the way through this season. We had the third longest winning streak in the country. We won 7 consecutive games this season, and for our kids to overcome all the different distractions and adversity that they had to overcome to get where they're at now is something real special, and it's because of these seniors. And to be able to win this football game would mean a whole lot to this program, but particularly our seniors.
Now, they've been through a lot. It takes a special kind of kid to go to a program, as was the case with the University of Texas El Paso 4 or 5 years ago, and to envision that you could be part of a great turnaround in a college football program, and that's what they've been, those seniors. Now Boise State second down and short. Hendricks under center. Quarterback throw. Hendricks reaches.
launches to the end zone. Touchdown!
Quarterback draw.
Nice call by Dirk Cutter, realizing that UTEP a little bit back on their heels, playing a little more conservatively down by their own end zone. Let the zone take place. Quarterback draw. Nobody's got him. Then Hendricks just turns it into a nice run.
Kalaikai's extra point. And Boise State back on top. 17 to 10, 18 seconds away from halftime.
One of the things that makes Hendricks so dangerous is his ability, as we talked earlier, to run and be effective with his feet. He lets the rush come in. He doesn't hurry it, and then he breaks the tackle right there at the goal line. He's a big kid, 215 pounds, but watch how he has the patience to let the rush get behind him, then follow his blocker, and then he just acts like a fullback right there. He just barely gets into the end zone, and tell you what, it'd be nice having some running backs show that kind of effort.
Bart Hendricks, no stranger to the end zone, as we showed you, 7 touchdowns. He's rushed for more than 50 yards in 4 games with a season high of 62 yards rushing against Central Michigan in September. And there is the scoring drive, and a lot of that was Bart Hendricks.
So many times you see an offense that's flat, and a defense makes the play, and it sparks the offense. And the turnover, the interception, gave their offense excellent field position, and they did something.
Kick off, kind of a pooch kick. Singleton out to the 30, turn back there. It'll be first down for UTEP with 11 seconds to go. They have one timeout remaining. A late touchdown run, a 12-yarder by Bart Hendricks. Cast a Boise State drive. And that has put Boise State on top late in this first half. Coming up, Chris Fowler. And the halftime report, Music City Bowl Preview, Insight.com Bowl Preview, and the Record Breakers. Rod Gilmore will join Chris in the studio, and that's just a few seconds away.
UTEP probably is not going to try anything super fancy right now. Maybe a little running play or just kill the clock as they do right now. And they have gotten into what they wanted to do in the second quarter. They need to carry it over in the second half.
So the tough first half for the Broncos and the Miners. Dirk Cutter heads to the locker room with his team up by 7 thanks to a late touchdown. Rocky Perez started out looking more at home.
And I think Gary Nord has got to be happy with the way he finished things in the second quarter as opposed to how we started things at the first quarter. Despite that last touchdown by Boise State, I think he's got his offense at least where it needs to be.
Well, you know, Boise State started this ball game coming off 2 tremendous offensive games at the end of the regular season where they scored 66 points in each game. And they got off to a quick start here today, didn't they?
Well, they had the big touchdown early. As you take a look at these highlights, it starts with Bart Hendricks hitting Chase Willie for the 28-yard touchdown. It gets them up early, and then it's the defensive turnovers that take over here. 4th and 1, they stop Roban Cleveland, force the turnover. UTEP gets back in the game, though. This 9-yard touchdown pass to Joey Knapp draws them in. Then after a turnover, Boise State retakes the lead to this 12-yard run by Bart Hendricks to give them the lead right before half, get that momentum a little bit back in their favor.
Take a look at the numbers in the first half of play, and the rushing yards, 0 for Boise State. And part of that were the 6 sacks to 35 yards in losses by the UTEP defense. Both teams, when they move the ball, pretty much moving it through the air.
So that second quarter, UTEP did get that running game going. If they can continue that, that's going to be a huge benefit. They're almost going to have to do that if they're going to try and get this game to the win column.
Big Brett Thompson has it on the tee, and Boise State kicking to UTEP to start the second half up 1. Javier Sanchez nearly able to bust it through. He got across the 30-yard line, and it'll be first down for University of Texas El Paso. The football just short of their 35. Boise State able to score on a late touchdown in the final minute of the first half to recapture the lead. But it seemed to us as we watched this game unfold that in the second quarter, Rocky Perez and the Miners were able to catch a rhythm against the Dirt Cutter's defense. Perez, 11 of 21, 133 yards passing. One touchdown, no interceptions in the first half. He missed his first four passes of the day. Running play. Chris Porter gets the call. Short yardage, kind of an attitude play to start the second half to the 35-yard line.
Wayne, if I'm Brent Guy, defensive coordinator for Boise State, I'm going to stop the run first. Perez has been hot. He's been off. But it's when the running game got going that the offense got going. And I'm going to be committed in this third quarter to stopping that run and make them beat me through the air, especially as it gets colder as the day goes on.
Sherman Austin in the backfield. He goes in motion. Second down. Quick hit. Porter trying to slip through the middle of the line, and he picks up some yardage across the 35-yard line. It'll be third down coming up for UTEP. First half leader.
Take a look here, and kind of mixed results. Perez, as you said, started cold, got hot. Porter, their main ball carrier, and Mays got involved. 5 receptions, 74 yards, but no real big plays. For Boise State, not much on the ground. Willie being the go-to guy through the air.
Third down, about 5. First drive of the second half from the shotgun. Perez, caught in the backfield. Tony Altieri, the sophomore from Vista, California, had one sack during the regular season and gets a big one on the first drive of the second half here.
Not a lot of pressure in the first half in the passing game by Boise State. This time it looks as though Perez had some time but had to step up. But you see 5 blue jerseys in the backfield. They didn't bring a lot of extra guys early, didn't have success. They started the third quarter having to bring more in order to put pressure on Perez.
Quentin Michael back deep to receive this kick from Glenn Beard. Over the far sideline, takes a minor hop. Michael makes the catch and is immediately escorted to the chalk marks on the far side. Early going, second half in Boise. UTEP defense came to the fore, led by Menson Holloway. They went after and got to Bart Hendricks.
Boy, they came from a lot of different areas, too. It wasn't just one guy. Not only did they have 6 sacks, but a lot of hits after Hendricks threw the ball. And in the end, it was their go-to guy, Menson Holloway. They came up with a couple of sacks. They have got to shore up that pass protection to get Bart Hendricks into a rhythm.
So it's first down for Boise State. Football to the 23-yard line, Bronco territory. First drive of the second half for Boise. Hendricks keeps it himself. Into the 20. To the 50. To the 40. And out of the field. Stick the period of the Bama. Nobody will catch him. Touchdown. Quarterback running pass and then beyond all those defensive backs.
Well, as you said, pass to beyond is the thing that steps up. He outran those defensive backs. Often you can see a quarterback break through the line of scrimmage on an option, but yet usually doesn't get past the defensive back as quick as he did, and then Wayne, they just couldn't catch him.
Tell you what, Goliath guy's extra point is good. Bart Hendricks, watch it again.
Take a look at 16, the free safety. He comes up, overruns it, and then he has a chance to recover. And as he tries to chase down Hendricks, we knew he had good speed. We were told 4.6. I guarantee you, he's running faster than 4.6 right
sure
there.
He sure is. He's outrunning D.J. Walker and Trance Clemens, the free safety and a right cornerback. My goodness.
Well, that's a lot longer than a 40-yard run, but what a heck of a play to start this second half.
Go down to Jim Barber on the sideline. Jim?
Guys, I got the impression, talking to Dirt Cutter at halftime, that maybe they had seen something in the first half they couldn't utilize and therefore implemented to start the second half. Chris Fowler in the studio said, I think things are going to open up in the second half, and oh my, have they already. In fact, Cutter also said, hey, if we can hit our receivers and get some protection on the left side of the line, watch out.
Jim, I got to think when Chris Fowler said open up, he wasn't thinking about Bart Hendricks on a 77-yard run.
Probably not, guys.
Boy, look at the smiles on the sideline for Boise State.
Now, Dirk Carter doesn't care if it was a 77-yard run or pass or kick return for all he cares.
I think that was a smile of surprise.
Wow. Surprise and relief.
Brett Thompson kicking off once again. Javier Sanchez threw his hands into the end zone. And he tipped it out of there for the touchback. Well, this bears watching again, doesn't it?
Well, you see the little reverse fake right there. It flows the support back on the other side. Then you saw the downfield block, and now the foot speed. Wayne, they're not only catching him, he's pulling away.
Oh, yeah. Nobody was going to catch him.
Just an outstanding play. Now, we've seen Bart Hendricks run the quarterback draw, run the option, and maybe turn a 4 or 5 yard gain into a 12-yard touchdown run. But that's just sheer athleticism there. That's just good feet.
They had another 10 yards to go. He would have been another 5 yards further beyond for the pursuit. Rocky Perez. Back near the 10-yard line. Pop. Jeff Kopp, the senior out of Idaho Falls, Idaho.
And you get the feeling that Dirk Cutter in the locker room at halftime for the last time with his Boise State team gave them quite an emotional talk, and I think it has served its purpose right now as they have come out with more emotion than I think at any point that they showed in the first half.
Loss of 8, second down and long coming up. Jeff Kopp, first team all Big West. Rocky Perez now has his work cut out for him. Big hole up the middle. Chris Porter busting it through across the 20-yard line. That time they caught the Broncos in the right kind of defense for that play. They spread him a bit and then busted the fullback up the middle.
Take a look at the way this hole opens up right here and how Porter delays where he's going. Nice blocking, wide open. And then once he gets that head of steam, he's big enough with 235 pounds. He's going to fall forward, pick up another 4 or 5 yards. Nice blocking up front by Clayton, the center, and Seton and Norman, the two guards.
Gain of 10. It's about third down and 8. 33% is Perez and company on third down today. They've got the bubble screen set up. Looking for Lee Mays on a slant off his hand, incomplete. Mays took a shot from Justin Howell. I don't think that play would have gotten a first down anyway had it been completed.
Well, it's the kind of play that you need to hit the receiver. If it's short of the first down, you've got to count on him to make a play after the catch. And then it's just up to that guy. It was kind of a moot point as the ball wasn't complete.
Glenn Beard, on in punt formation, first team all-WAC selection.
He's had a heck of a day, too. 52 yards, kicking in cold weather, goddamn.
This one, he shanks a bit toward the near side. Karam's out of bounds to the 41-yard line, Boise State. So the Broncos, with the momentum and the lead, and 11 minutes to go in the third, come back on the field offensively.
Thursday at 8 on ESPN. ESPN2's exclusive presentation of the 2000 Crucial.com Humanitarian Bowl is brought to you by Morgan Stanley Dean Witter. Move your money, get well connected. And by Bosch Platinum Bus 4. Take your engine to a higher power.
Bronco Stadium, and there is the Bronco. Penalty against UTEP. Unsportsmanlike conduct penalty was called, and now instead of getting it back into the 41-yard line, Boise State will start this drive at the 44 of UTEP. Hendricks in the shotgun on first down. Plenty of time. Nice catch, Quilly. Could he hang on? Nope. Could not quite hang on as he hit the turf hard near the 27-yard line. He was open underneath the coverage.
Not a great throw by Hendricks, but yet a ball that should have been caught. Here you see Swilly coming across, running away from man-to-man coverage. Hendricks throws the ball out in front of him, and like I said, a little low, but still should have been caught. Huge possession right here, Wayne, for UTEP's defense. The last two times they've been on the field, giving up two touchdowns. They need to stop here.
Boise State leading by its biggest margin of the afternoon, 14 points. Second down. The fake to Forsey. Minton Holloway would have none of it. Gain of a yard to the 43-yard line as Bart Hendricks is brought down by the defensive end. Has had an outstanding day here today thus far.
Well, he's played excellent in the passing game, a couple of sacks already, but I've been impressed with how he's also played the run. That's a good example right here. He did go for the inside fake, stayed in his position, made a nice tackle.
Third down and nine. Panucci at the bottom of your screen. It's generally been the go-to receiver, but not today. Hendricks wants it over the middle. Incomplete. Diving grab made by Jeb Boutier, but apparently trapped it on the turf at the 30-yard line. It's fourth down. Very important stand for the UTEP defense. There was a penalty marker thrown.
Pretty good coverage again by Grant Clement. The ball has to be thrown low, but not quite that low. Sincere, 6'5", has a hard time picking it up. And as Hendricks has come out here in the third quarter, made the big play on the ground, has been a little bit off through the air.
There was no penalty. It was the misreading Gary Nord's signal to his defense. It's like waving off a flag, but there was no flag on the play. The punt hangs up into the end zone, and it'll be first down for UTEP from the 20-yard line. ABC Sports is the home of the Bowl Championship Series, and on January 3rd, Josh Heupel and undefeated Oklahoma battle Heisman Trophy winner Chris Winkie and Florida State. The number one Sooners, the number three Seminoles in the BCS title game. The FedEx Orange Bowl, January 3rd, live, 8 p.m. Eastern, 5 Pacific on ABC Sports.
Boy, you know, Josh Heupel has done it ugly all year. Winkie's been the picture, but yet that's going to be a heck of a game.
What's ugly about 65% completion?
You know, there's nothing ugly about 12-0.
Yeah, you're right. Rocky Perez forced the other way, caught from behind. We talked about it at the top of the show today. The defensive ends have done a great job of keeping everything funneled to the inside all season. Jeff Kopp in that case, Zach Weber in the first half, have been outstanding for Boise State along the defensive front.
You hear about how good their secondary is. This isn't a coverage sack. That time you just saw Weber just beat his man and come through, and Perez didn't quite have enough quickness to get away from him, though by the time he saw him, it was almost too late.
A loss of just a yard, second and 11. Quick throw, Perez to the side. Lee Mays turns back short of the 30-yard line. Mays on a gain of about 10 yards. It'll be third and one coming up. Dempsey Dees, that has been a good battle. Mays and Dees, Quentin Michael helping out from his safety spot.
And both those players, as you said, Wayne, it's been an excellent battle. Both of them have had good moments and bad. This is what UTEP needs to do. Get the ball into the hands of their best players and let them make some plays. You got to get the ball to Napkin. You got to get the ball to Mays. One-on-one, isolated, and those guys just have to turn an average play into a big one.
Napkin and Mays combined for eight catches in the first half. Third and one, quarterback sneak. Rocky Perez on a quick move. It appears he's picked it up. So UTEP trailing by 14 here in the third quarter. Trying to mount some offense to get back into this game once again.
And this is certainly not a deficit that this team thinks they can't overcome. They have some big play ability. We just talked about it. And Perez can get hot and start hitting on different receivers. And when they get that running game going, that can complement what they do through the air. And they had that success in the second quarter. They just need to keep the ball and do what to do it. Keep getting first down.
Coming up on 8 minutes to go, third quarter. Boise State leading 24-10. First down for UTEP. Joey Knapp in motion. Play action, quick pressure. Immediate pressure on the play. They blitz Gennard Hart. And Hart gets in there for the sack. He had seven sacks in the regular season to lead the Big West Conference.
Well, you look at Boise State there. They only had 31 sacks for the season, and all four of the ones today have come in this half. And here you've just got no chance for Perez. Hart comes unblocked. Perez either has to get rid of that ball quickly or see it coming before the snap and audible to something else.
Second and 13. Perez to the flank. Allen Ray gunned down to the 30-yard line. Gain of about 3 yards. D. Ross, who came on as a senior, his first season starting for Boise State. He became first team all Big West and showed you why right there. A sure tackle to the 30.
Wayne, the best way to slow down an effective pass rush. You go on long count, you get them offside, you run your draws, you run your screens, the things that counteract an aggressive attack. And we need to see UTEP start doing some of those things because Boise State's having their way with that front seven defensively.
Third down, a little bit less than 10 yards to go. Perez. Some contact made with Netkin and the flag flies late. They isolated Sandoval on Netkin. And a late toss to the penalty flag. It's going to be pass interference, it looks like.
Wayne, the flag came in very late, but the field judge was trying to get it out right away.
It was frozen to his pocket.
He couldn't get it out. You can see where Netkin is right there.
He says, the guilty is automatic first down. It's a spotted foul. First down.
You can take a look at Netkin right here where he's lined up. He's going to come down and cut across. And Sandoval, number 7, the linebacker, is going to come up, just make contact with him. I actually think Sandoval was just looking at Perez as he was getting ready to throw the ball and step up.
Rayford Johnson, 1860 Olympic decathlon gold medalist, honored here at the Humanitarian Bowl. First down. There's that bubble screen or jailbreak play, as they call it, down in El Paso to Lee Mays. And he's got himself probably 7 yards or thereabouts. Mike Phillips recovered. Gain of 7 on the play. Bobby Hampton makes that good. Jack Weber also another stop. And Lee Mays gets up limping.
It's going to take a lot more than just a limp to keep him out. And he's had an outstanding day already. 7 receptions. And Rocky Perez going to the people he's got confidence in. Lee Mays, Brian Atkins, and Joey Knapp to continue to get involved out there.
Second down. Joey Knapp in motion. Jim Barber is down on the sidelines with a couple of guests, Jim.
And a couple of the celebrities. One you mentioned moments ago, Rayford Johnson, who was inducted into the World Sports Humanitarian Hall of Fame here in Boise back in 1994. Imagine you continue to relive those memories. A very special honor.
Oh, yeah, very much so. I've enjoyed coming up here subsequent to those years, and I appreciate what Myron is doing with this Hall of Fame. I think it's great for the community, certainly wonderful for the young people, and those who are inducted enjoy a great time in a very wonderful community.
And Ray Filari is the chairman of the organization, Larry Manili, and every year seems to be inducting some very special people.
Well, it's been a tremendous response from these legendary athletes and also from this community and around the country. We have a website, sportshumanitarian.com, and we invite people to visit and learn more about the organization. We're about to start on a capital campaign. We've got an endowment fund at Key Bank here in Idaho, and we want to build a permanent museum that will properly pay tribute to people like Rayford Johnson, who are doing so many wonderful things around the country and around the world.
And guys, Larry's a former broadcaster, and Rafer looks like he could still compete 40 years beyond the date in 1960.
And we're both real happy right here.
We'll keep you warm if we can.
You know what? We're real happy they're down there, too.
Second and 10, Perez.
They came right up the middle with Justin Powell, the linebacker, and he led a jailbreak of Broncos into the offensive backfield, a loss of 8.
Well, you could pick your angle as to which side this pressure's coming through. Right up the middle, coming from the right side. You see almost a hole right there by Chris Porter trying to keep the pressure off. But this is what Rocky Perez sees. Really, no chance at all. Justin Howell right up the middle. And the pass protection that Rocky Perez enjoyed in the first half has disappeared.
Justin, we make that Chenard Hartz also in on that sack along with Justin Howell. Now third and long, and they come running out of it. This is Chris Porter. He's got some open field. Porter out of bounds, and it appears he's got a first down near the 42-yard line of Boise State. Greg Sasser chased him out. 18-yard gain, Randy.
You talked about how draws can slow down a pass rush. Boise State coming with the blitz again, and Porter effectively running the draw, letting the rush get behind him, and then it's just wide open once he gets past the line of scrimmage.
For the Crucial.com Humanitarian Bowl, Bronco Stadium. Do not adjust the color on your set. That is a blue field indeed. Wayne Larrabee, Randy Wright, Jim Barber. And UTEP, new life on this drive with a first down. At the Boise State 42. Blitz on, Perez wide of the mark. Tessier in the general vicinity of that pass. Gennard Hart came off the edge.
This is where you need your game breaker like Lee Mays in there. Now, he's still on the sideline as he came limping off the field. But as Boise State is bringing 7, 8, 9 guys, you need to be able to hit your receiver, let them break a tackle, and turn it into a touchdown. Without Mays, Perez doesn't really have that other go-to guy out there that can turn it into 6.
He's got Brian Neskin, who can get him a good game, but the guy who can break the game is Mays, and there he is right there.
Especially going against the blitz.
Tessier was the man in motion. Well set up sweep. Porter running hard inside the 40-yard line to be 36 and a gain of 6 yards. Justin Howell takes him down from the linebacking core.
Take a look here. You'll see the sweep coming to the right, and he's got his center right there, right in front of him, leading the way, and he's well past the line of scrimmage before he ever makes hit. It's nice to run behind a guy like Terry Clayton.
Third down for UTEP. Third and about 4. Determined finish to that run, and that got him the first down and about 3 yards more to the 29-yard line. Dempsey Dees took the brunt of the hit from Chris Porter, a 5'11", 235-pound junior out of San Antonio.
Good call, Wayne. It was a good finish that got him the first down, but you see that little dip move halfway through that run that put him in the position to get there. Not a lot where the hole was designed to go, where the ball was designed to go. Dipped it to the outside, picked up some extra yards.
Ray and Tessier at the bottom of your screen. Sherman Austin didn't get a whole lot. The second wave able to get there for Boise State. That second wave led by the middle linebacker Justin Howell, who has shown up big on this drive. Sean Sandoval was also there.
Linebackers have been a bit of a disappointment this year for Boise State. Justin Howell and Sean Sandoval have not maybe played as well as what Brent Guy would like them to have played, but that play, nice job.
Yeah, they lost a couple of outstanding linebackers in this program last year.
This is the kind of drive that UTEP needed. The defense has been struggling. Now a nice long drive, 15 plays, but they have to finish with the ball in the end zone.
Collision in the backfield, fumble picked up by Neskin. And then lost again, but Neskin was down. Dempsey Dees got up with it. He's running for the end zone, but he's just warming up. That's just a wind sprint for him because they're bringing this one back. Neskin was down. Jeff Topp got in there to help blow up the play. Neskin was down to the 35. He recovered the fumble and watched the collision in the backfield between Austin and Perez.
Well, Austin is a back that took over for Porter. He went out a couple plays ago, a mixed up with Perez, and yet whenever you see your tight end lane this far back in the backfield, someone's not doing a great job blocking. As you said there, you saw Jeff Kopp all over the ball.
They apparently ruled that Austin was down back near the 35, not Neskin. Neskin did recover the fumble, but they spotted the ball just inside the 35. And I think the Boise State coaches are wondering why they did that. If Neskin did recover the fumble, and if he was down by contact, it would have been out beyond the 35-yard line. And now the officials have called for a timeout. Apparently, UTEP will talk things over. We've got a bruise on one play.
And both were clearly fumbled. Take a look. This is where the pressure comes from. Right there, Jeff Kopp. Now, the first fumble occurs when Perez and Austin bang in the backfield. Clearly a fumble. Natkin picks it up right there. You can see that ball is already coming out. Should have been a second fumble. Should be Boise State's ball right there, if not a touchdown by Dempsey Dees.
A touchdown by Dempsey Dees. Meanwhile, UTEP getting sent for the 17th play of this drive. They've held the football 7 minutes and 41 seconds, covering 45 yards so far.
And they've been able to overcome some sacks and still pick up a first down. Third and 15, they got to do it again.
Big haul up the middle. Chris Porter once again roped down near the 26-yard line. Chenard Hart made the stop. That saved a first down. The Morgan Stanley Dean Witter well-connected storyline. Take a look at Bart Hendricks. 237 total yards, three touchdowns. UTEP, 222. They've been held in check for the most part. Their season average, 407. And the sacks today, UTEP has brought the pressure. They said they were going after Bart Hendricks. Indeed, they have. 43-yard field goal attempt coming up here for Ricky Bishop. Left-footed kicker with a strong leg. Gets this one on its way right down the boulevard. It is good, and then some. So Bishop, a senior out of El Paso, playing his final game for UTEP. Pokes it through the upright. And it's a 24-13 Boise State lead. Award-winning Sports Century continues, bringing you fascinating and compelling stories of all the great sports figures and personalities of the 20th century. Friday at 8 Eastern on ESPN Classic, it's an hour devoted to Michael Jordan. See the profile of one of the greatest athletes of all time, complete with interviews and highlights from his illustrious career. To order ESPN Classic, dial 1-800-CLASSIC or call your cable provider. Jim Barber's got a special guest on the sideline.
He is the governor of the state of Iowa, Dirk Kempthorne, who has seen a pretty exciting game, and equally as important to the economy of Idaho is this football game. I don't see many interest in the stands today.
Jim, it's a full stadium today, and it just, what we have for the first Humanitarian Bowl. I mean, people turned out for this bowl. We're so proud. These two teams are doing wonderful out here.
Governor, we appreciate you stopping by and the great efforts you put towards this state.
Well, Jim, thank you. I just wish you could see the snow-capped mountains. We took a lot of these Texas players up snowmobiling. They've had a great time here. So come see Idaho.
All right, thank you, Governor, and back to you guys.
All right, thank you, Jim. Here's the kickoff by Ricky Bishop. Brock Forsey makes the catch at the four. Got a good block and breaks through across the 30. Got a good block from his co-defect, David Michael, and springs across the 30-yard line. Boise State will put it in play. Well, the governor was talking about snowmobiling. There are the foothills right there. We're on the Boise front. The UTEP Miners did something a little bit out of the ordinary for their Christmas holiday, at least for them.
Your parking brake, squeeze your brake lever.
I'm from Southern California, so I'm used to, you know, riding the surfboard. He's obviously go a little bit faster when you go on the surfboard.
A little bit faster. Then when you're on a surfboard, that was John Dornbus, the deep snapper for UTEP. A little snowmobiling action in the mountains for the Miners. Brock Forsey running hard, gain of about almost 4 yards on that play. Kamar Jackson, the linebacker, made the stop.
Boise State, I'm sure, would like to be able to have an effective ground game here. It takes some time off the clock. They still got that 11-point lead. And one of the things that has made them so effective this year, when they do have a lead, they've got a good enough game to be able to do that. Chew up some time. Usually, though, whether it's on the ground or in the air, it's in the end zone.
They got a guy ranked sixth in the nation in all-purpose yardage behind the quarterback, Brock Forsey. And here he comes. Brock Forsey taking that pitch from Bart Hendricks, and this time the play well snuffed out. Rick Fetty and A.J. Shepard up to make a hit.
Nice play by Fetty. Staying at home at his defensive end position, forces Hendricks into the pitch, is quick enough to get over in front of Forsey and get involved on the tackle also. That's just an outstanding play.
So it's third down and about 9 yards to go. Loss of a couple on that last play. Time winding down, third quarter here in Boise. A short drop by Hendricks, trying to hit the stamp. The slant, he gets it to Finucci across the 35. Finucci on a gain of about 4 yards, not enough of the first down. Trent Clemens defended it well. So the third period has come to a close. Boise State took a 14 quarter, shows the Miners need some offense in the fourth quarter. Meanwhile, Boise State, 17 consecutive games of 34 points or more. And they're within six of that mark. Confirmation time. Jeff Edwards for Boise State kicking it away. High snap. Good catch, and he's running it. And he's got a first down and more. Into UTEP territory, inside the 45, out of bounds to the 41-yard line.
You know, sometimes, Wayne, when it's your last game as a coach here, you can do some of those things, and you can have some fun, especially when they work. UTEP has been putting pressure all day on Edwards, but watch how this opens up. There's the hole, just like a sweep. Nice job breaking the tackle right there. Boy, what a surprise, and a nice play giving Boise State the first down.
Mark Doughty missed the tackle on the punter. 22-yard gain to a first down. Hendricks and company back on the field. Brock Forsey. It opens up like the Red Sea for Moses. Complexion of this game for good. 30-0, Boise State.
And you see how one play has such a major impact on the other play. You have to finish. You have to take advantage of opportunities. And Dirk Cutter there shows something by faking the punt, picking up the first down, and then calling a little misdirection play. And I don't think UTEP ever recovered from the fake punt.
Nick Kalayakai has the extra point. Dirk Cutter's team in the end zone once again. Brock Forsey, last year's Humanitarian Bowl MVP, reaches pay dirt once again. The minor comeback efforts will be further impaired by the injury to Lee Mays, the great wide receiver being carted off here a moment ago. Meanwhile, Brock Forsey, been outstanding again in the Humanitarian Bowl. Watch this, though, the fake punt by Jeff Edwards, and he gets 22 yards out of this. That prolongs the drive and puts the defense back on the field, and they can't catch Brock Forsey as he went through a hole off the left side.
I don't know if you could have three more devastating scenes in a row. Mays being carried off, then the fake punt and the touchdown. And as I said, Dirk Cutter there, you be a little more fly by the seat of your pants when it's your last game. You've got this kind of lead. It couldn't have worked out better for himself and his team.
Sanchez has this one sail past him into the end zone. It'll be first and 10 of the 20-yard line. Jim Barber, what's the feeling down the UTEP sideline?
As you might expect, guys, not a good one. A lot of anger after the misses and the tackles and trying to stop the fake punt. And then after that, just a strong emotional letdown because of the touchdown. You get the feeling now that this team not only has to fight an 18-point deficit, but the emotional loss because of what has happened just moments ago.
And meanwhile, on the other side, for the 18th consecutive game, Dirk Cutter's team has scored 30 points or more. 31 at the moment. In 11 of their last 18 games, they've gone over 40 points. And they put 66 on the board in each of their last two home games here at Bronco Stadium. Rocky Perez, work cut out for him. Wide open, Brian Netkin. Quinton Michael makes the tackle. First down to the Boise State 43.
Nice job by Perez, finding the open receiver. He got protection, and then he just throws the strike to Natkin. And with Mays out, Natkin and Joey Knapp have both got to step up and maybe play a bigger role. Good job, though, turning what could have been a disaster into a huge play by hitting his receiver over the middle instead of letting the seed get away from him.
36-yard pass play. First down to the 44. Blitz coming. Perez hit as he throws. Incomplete. They brought the pressure from the far side. Wes Nurse, the linebacker, a freshman out of Federal Way, Washington. And he came with authority.
Well, the pressure's been intense here in this second half. And now with a 31-13 lead, knowing that UTEP has got to throw the ball, I look for Boise State to continue to do the same thing, especially with Mays out, so therefore you can take a few more chances.
in motion. They go to Chris Porter, running hard, breaking tackles inside the 34-yard line. He's got a first down to the 33.
Well, part of the UTEP offense has got to involve the running game. It's something they do too well, and it's a compliment to the passing game. If they get out of the running game completely, I don't think they have a real chance to overcome this lead, because Boise State has just come after them, so they have to continue to at least mix in their running game.
First down. Pass knocked away. Shenard Hart, second time he's batted down a pass today.
You know, you talk about Boise State's offense and how they really don't have a go-to guy. It's mixed up with a lot of different receivers. You could say the same thing about their defense. They have several guys that step up and play. Shenard Hart, Quentin Michael. Today we've seen Zach Weber and Jeff Kopp. It's really a team effort that Dirk Cutter has built here. And I think with Cutter and his staff being gone, it's up to the players to continue to have that carry over.
Second and 10. Porter again, trying to break a tackle and reaches inside the 30-yard line. Well, you mentioned it. The most interceptions by any Boise State defender this year were two by several. They had 13 interceptions, Randy, on the season. Almost half of those interceptions, for example, came against Idaho in the season finale here at Broncos Stadium. But that doesn't mean this has not been an effective defense. They've done so many other things. 31 sacks, number one in their conference in that category. Third down here for Rocky Perez. Here comes the blitz again. Incomplete. It appeared the pass was dropped by Joey Knapp. He had good coverage by Wes Nurse.
I think the ball hit Knapp right in the chest, and Rocky Perez had to get rid of that ball quickly because the rush was coming. Knapp took his route, turned his head maybe a little slower, not realizing that. The timing was just destroyed, but Perez did a nice job standing in there, and Knapp just got to get his head around a little quicker. You just got a sense that pressure's going to come. You know they're blitzing. They've been blitzing the whole half. You got to get your head around.
Rocky Perez is one tough hombre. I don't look for him to back down here at all. Timeout called by UTEP. They want to talk over this fourth down play. Trailing 31.
ESPN2's exclusive presentation of the 2000 Crucial.com Humanitarian Bowl is presented by Crucial.com, the memory experts, and in part by your local Lincoln dealer. Lincoln, American luxury.
Beautiful Sun Valley, world-class skiing here in Idaho. Not far, about an hour and a half from Boise or thereabouts.
I imagine it depends on how fast you try to get there.
They're going to try for a field goal, are the Miners of UTEP. 47-yard field goal attempt by Ricky Bishop. His long this season is 48. It was in much warmer weather than this.
He's only 3 for 7 outside of 40 yards.
Today he's made good on 28 and 43-yard field goal attempts. Here comes the kick to the uprights, and it's good. That young man's got a pretty good leg on him, doesn't
Boy,
he?
That one cleared by a lot. That was a heck of a kick.
So the Miners back to within 31-16 in college football's second season at ESPN. Two great bowl matchups coming your way today. First at 4 Eastern, the Music City Bowl from Adelphia Coliseum in Nashville, Tennessee. It's the matchup of Ole Miss challenging West Virginia. Don Nealon's final game at West Virginia. Then at 7:30 Eastern, wide receiver Antonio Bryant leads the Pitt Panthers to Bank One Ballpark in Phoenix, Arizona for the Insight.com Bowl. They'll face the Iowa State Cyclones. There is Coach Nealon, 30 seasons as a head coach, 21 at West Virginia. This is his 13th bowl game. And he'd like to end it on a high note.
West Virginia 0-8 in their last bowl game.
Yep. Ouch. Kind of nice to see him win that, wouldn't it?
That'd be good for that program. That'd be good for him. He's done a lot for college ball. That'd be a good way to go out. You may ask why UTEP kicks the field goal there. They were down by 18. Now they're down by 15. Two touchdowns, two-point conversion. They need to get a field goal somewhere along the way.
Kickoff, short. David Michael flips the defender to 25. gets out just short of the 30-yard line near the 29. So it'll be first down coming up.
Hey, there's a lot to cheer about for those young fans. Who knows, maybe one of those guys will be wearing a Bronco uniform. And what do you think, Randy, about 10, 15 years or so?
One or the other. I'd say about 12. How's that for walking the middle of the road?
You know, you can play college football at nearly any age if you have eligibility. We saw that this year down at Florida State, didn't we?
Maybe the new thing.
Yes, it is.
Got a feeling that's gone on in Nebraska for quite a while.
First down just short of the 29. Tripping out of the backfield, Davey Malathon, senior from Merced, California. I think Dirk Cutter's going to try to get his seniors into this lineup here. The seniors at Boise State have come through a lot over their 5 years. We've talked about the turnaround in the program that the seniors have really helped fuel down at UTEP, but here they've gone through three or four coaching staff, depending on how you want to look at it. The fifth-year seniors have seen an awful lot and grown up and matured over the years. Bart Hendricks, one of them. On the reverse, Gilligan, Tim Gilligan, that sweeper reverse, they call it. He becomes a sweeper back, a wide receiver in the slot. They bring him across the formation. We saw them run it to Brock Forsey earlier today, and this time they give it to the wide receiver, Gilligan, who got maybe a yard or two back. Third and 10 coming up, and a minor down on the field.
It's a play that can be very effective.
Mark Doughty, a safety, comes back onto the field. He'll replace, at least physically replace, A.J. Shepard. Shepard is the quarterback of that defensive secondary. Third down and 10 for Boise State. Gary Nord trying to keep his troops involved, keep them in it. They've got some time, but it's starting to become a factor. They need to get the Boise State offense off the field right here. Hendricks hit as he throws it over the middle. Well-defensed play. Brock Forsey on the reception. The tackle made downfield by Tim Woodard. Pressure came right up the middle.
When you talked a lot about Dirk Cutter in that system, is here you see some of the players he's developed. Hendricks standing in there again, taking the hit. So he really hadn't had that many hits here in the second half. He's had a lot of things go his way. Those are nice ball there. Boy, I tell you, those hits hurt that much more when you're playing on a cold day, but a lot easier to take when you're ahead 31-16 than maybe in that second quarter when they were not doing quite as well.
Javier Sanchez back deep. Jeff Edwards in punt formation. This time he kicks it. Sanchez. Good move across the 30. 35, stumbling 40. Still on his feet, 45. He's out near the midfield marker. Excellent return by Javier Sanchez, and a penalty marker's thrown on the play. Penalty markers are down, and maybe for a face mask.
AT&T brought
here Jeff Kopp on Javier Sanchez.
You can see him grab the face mask right there, but then he doesn't let go, and if he's getting blocked, he's falling backwards. If he just let go, maybe it's a 5-yarder. The fact that he's getting blocked, holds on to it, twists the head, therefore the 15-yarder. Wayne, this game, by no means, is out of reach. UTEP takes over 35 yards away from a touchdown, and they're just two touchdowns and a couple conversions away.
Well, that's right. That penalty sets them up in Boise territory, the Bronco 35. Perez in the shotgun. Sherman Austin. Nice cut for the first down at the 24 to Chris Fowler in the studio.
Well, guys, in Nashville at the Music City Bowl, Don Nealon's swan song, and West Virginia strikes first. It's Brad Lewis. Goes to the 290-pound fullback, the ex-guard Wes Howes, who rumbles in. Ole Miss just kicks a field goal to answer.
My goodness, Chris, I bet you that young man lost 5 pounds on that run.
When did they put in the guard eligible? That's not a fullback.
That's outstanding. First down of the 24. Blitz coming from the Broncos. They're coming off the edge. Perez rolls away from it, screens it out, and overshot. A pretty well wide open Sherman Austin on the play.
Once again, you see Zach Weber back in the backfield, putting a little pressure on Perez. You know you're going to get hit on the screen because they let the rush come in. You just have to plant your feet and make sure you throw an accurate pass. That's a big play UTEP let get away from it. Or potentially a big play they let get away from it.
Second and 10 at the 24 of Boise State. 15-point lead for the Broncos. Just under 10 and a half to go. Porter up the middle. Zach Weber on the stop at the 20-yard line, gain of 4. Jim Barber, what have you found out on the status of Lee Mays, the wide receiver for the University of Texas El Paso?
Wayne, for Lee, it's a bad ankle sprain. They're x-raying it as we speak, not likely to come back. As for A.J. Shepard, he is okay, but the news not promising for Mays. That was a pretty bad ankle injury.
Lee Mays coming back toward the field, but he's on crutches. I don't think he's going to play. Third down. Third and 6. Porter going to have to get it pretty much on his own. Not going to get there. Turned back near the 17-yard line. It's a gain of about 3 yards, maybe 4. And as I mentioned, Lee Mays heading back toward the field of play, but doesn't appear to be in any kind of shape to return to this game. And that's a huge weapon that you take out of the arsenal for UTEP in their comeback attempt.
Well, he gives you that ability to catch up from anywhere on the field. Now UTEP has got to do it a little more methodically with the running game, and one reason why they go for it here on fourth down.
Fourth and 3, they've got a 5-receiver set, quarterback keeper Rocky Perez, first down and goal, inside the 10 to the 7-yard line.
Red, not known as quite the same kind of runner that a Bart Hendricks is, but that ability to get through there and use your feet adds so much to your offense. Feeling Boise State's going to blitz. They've been doing it quite a bit. Nice call. Good job of execution by that offensive line.
First and goal for the Miners. Blitz coming. Porter gets the call, spins his way to the 5, maybe the 4, as they spot the football. Sasser responding along with D. Ross. Gain of about 3.
When you see where that short punt and then the penalty after that really gives UTEP the opportunity to keep their running game involved. When you take over on such a short field, you can go with the one thing that's working for you, which is that running game, because that's what's been moving the ball down here so far.
Double tight down the line. Second and goal to go just inside the 5. Perez, incomplete. Tessier, the intended receiver, was tied up with Dempsey Deeds.
Sometimes when you've been hit as much as Perez has here in this second half, you kind of anticipate the hit coming, sometimes when they're not there. There's a little play action. He turns and throws the ball. He's got a guy right in his face, but you can see the receivers haven't even got into a position or anywhere close to being able to catch that ball. You got to protect Perez a little better than they have, a lot better than what they have.
Looks like offsetting penalties coming up here or not. Apparently a man downfield illegally against UTEP, ineligible downfield.
We have an ineligible receiver downfield against the offense. The penalty is 5 yards from the previous spot. Replay second down.
So not offsetting penalties. They do get second down again. It's second down and goal to go. The football back at the 10-yard line.
One of the risks you run with a play-action pass is that you're trying to sell the run. A lineman may get a yard or two downfield and trying to do that. That time they got caught.
Red zone penetrations. UTEP has been good to go. Touchdown and 2 field goals. They need a touchdown here, though. Perez out of the shotgun. Threads the needle, Nurkin latching on, no, could not hang on, penalty marker thrown. Quentin Michael was in his shirt. Nurkin couldn't quite hang on, Perez tried to thread the needle. And we may have pass interference here.
Good call. I thought there was clearly contact between Michael and Nurkin, and it was a pretty well thrown ball. Without the contact, I think that Nurkin catches it.
Yeah, pass interference against the defense. The penalty will place the ball at the 2-yard line with automatic first down.
Not not necessarily a great break for UTEP because this could have been a touchdown. Nice move right there. And watch Michael come up early. Clearly hits him early with what was a pretty well-thrown ball right in front of Nashville.
First down and goal to go at the two. Chris Porter met by a posse of Broncos. Jim Barber, they've been physical on these receivers here, haven't they?
Yes, they have, guys. They could have called pass interference a couple occasions from my vantage point. Boise State has been in the shirts of the receivers at UTEP. And if they choose to pass again, they're going to have to watch themselves defensively because the officials are watching even closer here.
Second down. Loss of one on the play. Porter this time to the end zone. Touchdown! Give the Miners credit. They could have packed up and gone home back in the third quarter. But they have taken Boise State's best shot and come back with one of their own. And they're right back in this game.
And they're not over yet. And now you're going to have to go for two on one of the two touchdowns before you win the game. So you either go for it here or you wait and you go for it on the next one. Here they're lining up to go for the one. Whether they fake it or not, let's wait and see.
I don't know if they have that in the playbook or not. Ricky Bishop for the point after. And he kicks it away to the uprights. John Dornbus, number 47, is the deep snapper for the Miners, and he has been quite a magician over the years. I was going to say musician, but watch this magic here. John Dornbus, take a look at it right here. He's got that. He's going to get that thing elevated. This youngster is quite a story. Lost his parents when he was just 12 years old. Eventually was raised by an aunt and uncle in Los Angeles, California. He's worked at Planet Hollywood in front of the likes of Bruce Willis and Sylvester Stallone. And how about that? Watch that.
You know, we were standing right in front of him when he was doing it, and we still couldn't figure out how he was doing it.
All right.
You know what? Once he learns to come out of his shell a little bit, he'll really have a future. But boy, the guy's mature well beyond his years. Yeah. And for somebody who's had some of the breaks that he's had, as you said, losing both of his parents when he was 12, he's turned out to be a super kid and has turned it into as good a thing as he can to learn from it and to grow from it.
Here's the kickoff. Brock Forsey escaping to the outside. Good tackle made on the flank by Mark Doughty, the free safety who missed a tackle earlier on the punter, Jeff Edwards, that allowed a first down, but this time makes the stop on the kickoff return. So 32-yard line, first down. UTEP far from out of this game, and Gary Nord's done a good job of rallying the troops through some adversity here today, not just the weather, the loss of Lee Mays, their All-America caliber wide receiver. They just went for a touchdown drive to get back into the game. And now Boise State will try to answer. Good play fake, Hendricks. Hit as he throws. Had a man open through the hands of Snelling, the tight end, across the midfield marker.
Unusual formation for Boise State. Two back, two tight end. But yet they run the play action. Snelling is open. And what a throw by Bart Hendricks right in the face of pressure. Knowing he's going to get hit. Snelling's got to make this catch, Wayne. It's a play that you're not going to get a lot of opportunities to succeed. There's the hit coming. That's just a beautiful throw right there. Snelling's got to come down with that.
Second and 10. Hendricks again under pressure, screens it out. Shea Swan, the fullback, cutting it back. Penalty marker thrown on the play. Gain of yardage out near the midfield marker.
We're going to have an illegal block or a holding against Boise State on the run. And whenever Boise State has gotten in trouble, they have gone back to that simple little high-percentage screen play. And every time they've done it, Wayne, it's worked for them.
It's popped big, hasn't it? And we're talking gaping gains of 10, 15, 18 yards. Blocked below the waist against Boise State. And that will take the air out of that one.
Dirk Cutter knows that this game is not over, and he has not been able to stop.
He has a crackback block, blocking below the waist. Against the offense, 15-yard penalty from the spot of the foul. Replays it down.
He's basically going to go back to about where the line of scrimmage was, maybe a few more yards back. But Dirk Cutter knows his defense hasn't been able to stop UTEP. He's got to continue to be productive offensively. Go back to the screen, coming right at you here. The ball gets to Swan very well. Take a look at the low block right there. Kind of a low hurdle, but a good call. You can't do that and wipes out what was a huge play at a key time.
Dirk Cutter will be heading to Arizona State with seven members of his staff following this game. Second down and long coming up here for Boise State. Hendricks looking to make a play. The ball high, missed him. Knocked out of bounds to the far side by Paul Smith, the linebacker.
Well, a huge play. You go back to that penalty. That would have given Boise State a first down, let them run time off this clock. You've got less than 7 minutes to go now. Because of that, you've got a second and 20. That play now just picking up 8 yards. You've got a third and 12. Do you run? Maybe not get it. Do you throw? Risk the clock stopping? Oh, huge, huge impact that penalty had. It really, Wayne, it had no impact on the play. The block was well beyond the ball carrier.
Time becoming a factor. 6.5 to go in the game. Hendricks to the air. Hook the air. Wide open at the 46-yard line. Trance Clemens made the stop. First down, Boise State on a 16-yard gain.
Well, you got to give Bart Hendricks a lot of credit to find the matchup that he wanted, but there's another flag down, that's down, and this is also going to come back and wipe out a second key first down on this drive.
So another flag.
They have illegal motion against the offense, movement before the snap, 5-yard penalty, replay third down.
And the line judge made that call on the near side, threw the flag right on the sidelines.
Wayne, two penalties. Totally needless penalty, illegal formation, movement, and then you have the block earlier behind the ball carrier. Neither one of them should have happened. Here, though, you take a look at Hendricks finding the mismatch, throwing a strike, all for nothing.
How much can they overcome on this drive? Third and 17 now. Blitz on. Hendricks wide of the mark. Trying to get it to his go-to man today, Brock Forsey. And the Miners have held.
Well, many times it would have been easy for UTEP to have cashed it in, as you referred to earlier. They haven't. They fought themselves back into a position where now they look to get pretty good field position, down by a touchdown and a two-point conversion, and plenty of time on the clock. And their offense has to be feeling pretty good about how they've been moving the ball.
Indeed they do. Jeff Edwards on in punt formation once again. Snap off the mark a bit. Line drive kick, Sanchez toward the far sideline. Makes the first man miss. Gets the block on the second. Turns upfield and cuts it back. He fumbles the football across the midfield marker. Recovered by UTEP, I believe. Woodard's got it back. No, wait a minute. It's still up for grabs at the bottom of the pile. Tim Woodard fell on it for UTEP, but I believe Boise State gets it back. And they do.
Wait, how could UTEP not get on that ball? There were three or four players that clearly had a first shot at getting it before any blue jersey got there. They misplayed the ball, and Boise State gets a huge break.
Davey Malliathon got it back. A huge, huge setback for UTEP now with 5.5 minutes to go in the game.
Take a look at the fumble right there. The ball just squeezes out. And look at all the white jerseys that have the opportunity to get this right there. And they just can't come down with it.
Travis Berger is the man who popped it loose. And now UTEP back on defense. Boise State return to the offensive. Mensen Holloway just destroyed the block attempt of Peter Nomes.
Take a look at the end of the fumble here, and Brian Walker has his chance. It just slides right over the ball, And then that second wave of blue coming in there winds up getting it. Take a look at the sack, and Holloway just gets around Namez and gets through on Hendricks. And I got to say, a little surprised at that call right there. Instead of running the ball, taking some time off the clock, now you put yourself with the sack in the same position you were in previously, second long.
Second and 17, screen play, wide of the mark. Brock Forsey out in front of that play, however, was A.J. Shepard. And had Forsey been able to rein that one in, Shepard would have had him dead to rights. So it becomes third and 17 now for Boise State. You're right, Randy. You got to wonder about that play call on first down there. Bart Hendricks in the second half, not nearly as accurate as he was in the first half of the ball game.
And not many opportunities. Boise State came out. He had the long run. Sometimes on cold days when you're a quarterback that's used to throwing the ball 30, 35, 40 times, when you only throw it seven times and a half, you're not going to be as accurate on the times you do throw it.
Lou Finucane is a go-to receiver at the bottom of your screen. They haven't gone through him much here today. Hendricks looked that way initially. Comes back over the middle. Great catch. Banks on the reception. Got a first down to the 46-yard line of UTEP. Weldon Cooks was the man he beat on a down and in pattern.
Big, big play. We haven't heard much of Banks today. I look at quarterback. How do you do in the red zone? How do you do on third down? Hendricks throws a strike when he needed one. Nice route. That was really pretty good coverage that time by Cook. Just a perfect pass by Hendricks.
So UTEP trailing 31-23. Boise State on the drive at the 46 of the Miners. Under 4.5 to go for the game. Safety got over to make the stop.
A good call by Dirk Cutter, realizing that UTEP was going to be in a position to have to come after them. He puts his fullback in motion, a guy that's been quiet all day, and UTEP just doesn't get out there and cover it. Looked like it was a zone coverage, and they were focused on the inside receiver, forgot all about the running back.
36-yard gain, just outside the 10 for Boise State. Trying for the clinching score. In motion, they give it to him. He's coming back the other way, going for Hendricks. Caught by Hendricks, touchdown! Miraculous caught, catch by Hendricks. He caught it over Gabe Wilkins, a defensive end.
A couple opportunities that UTEP had to make some plays in that drive. Results in the Boise touchdown, but what a chance Gabe Williams had maybe to get an interception. I thought it was going to be intercepted, but Hendricks just goes up, takes it away from him.
There's 98 in your picture. Watch him drift back now. He's all of a sudden he realized, wait a minute, Hendricks is the intended receiver. Hendricks took it away from him.
He just clearly goes up and takes it away.
Kalaikai has the extra point. Away from Gabe Williams, turned it into a touchdown for Boise State. Sanchez against the better wishes of his deep back mate. Sam Singleton gets it out to the 15-yard line. And it'll be first down for UTEP from there. Bart Hendricks has been outstanding today, Randy.
Well, you know that he had to play big in order for Boise State to have success. And he does it so many different ways. Through the air, on the ground, with his leadership. Turns a play that I was shocked he had this kind of speed. And wouldn't it be ironic if a guy that has set so many passing records and so much success through the air winds up finishing up with a reception to end his career.
Capital One player of the game, Bart Hendricks. Rocky Perez goes back to work. Tessier out of bounds at the 20-yard line. Gain of about 5.
The job he's done. It's just been outstanding. He's got a 7-year extension on his contract. They're extremely excited about what they're doing down in El Paso and the future of his program.
And the thing the players and coaches talked about, what heartened them most about this season was the enthusiasm of the El Paso community rallying around this football team, which at one stage of the season had a 7-game winning streak, a co-championship with TCU and the WAC. Just outstanding season for UTEP. Well, Boise State, I talked about it a little bit earlier. Their fifth-year seniors have come through a lot. This is a third down call. Rocky Perez gets out near the first down at the 19, or at the 24-yard line. Not sure if he got it. Depends on the spot of the ball. But I mentioned the Boise State kids. Their fifth-year seniors, Randy, have come through a lot. They were recruited by the late Pokey Ellen. They saw the coach who recruited them pass away. They played under interim coach Tom Mason. Houston Nutt was here for 1 year. In the last 3 years, Dirk Cutter. In the last 2 years, have resulted in incredible seasons for this program. So they, too, have matured over the years. Pass wide of the mark. They had a first and 10. And Jim Barber down to the sideline. Jim?
Guys, the first time we've seen Dirk Cutter smile in such a long time, just moments after the touchdown was scored. And you wonder if some of the seniors realize this is the last moments playing for him and also playing with the rest of their teammates who will inherit a different team next year and a different coach. But this is perhaps the first moment in this game this team is starting to recognize the fact that they are in command to win this football game and send Dirk out the right way.
Jeff Kopp, Zach Weber, Bradley Phillips, all seniors on that defensive front that's played well here today for Boise State. Out of the shotgun, second and 10. Perez, boy, good coverage right there. I mean, talk about a close to the ball. Ray, Allen Ray, the reception, and D. Ross, a senior from Marion, Ohio. First team all Big West selection. I talked of him earlier, his first season as a starter. He made a sure tackle there, preventing any first down. And kept him in play. That's important, too. Time winds down. Blitz coming. Perez hit as he throws. He'll be fourth down coming up. 5 yards to go. The thunder off the edge all afternoon has been Zach Weber, and he got to the quarterback once again, number 97.
Came in with only 5 sacks that he had all year, and he has just wreaked havoc all day for Rocky Perez, especially in the second half. Tremendous protection the first half. Took advantage of it. Nice job. Second half, Boise State just came out with a different attitude. They haven't stopped or let up since.
Four down territory and naked gun, Rocky Perez. Everybody out for a pass. Nearly intercepted by Shenard Hart. Intended for the All-America, Brian Natchin. And this one is pretty much salted away with 2:19 to go in the game. Dirk Cutter rallying the troops perhaps one last time. One first down, he says. Get one first down, and we can kill the clock.
Well, UTEP only has the one timeout left, and I'm sure we'll see Boise State just keep that ball on the ground. They can only stop it once. And as you said, the one first down, just steal it away for them.
Well, last year it was Brock Forsey who was the Humanitarian Bowl MVP. This year I would have to guess it would be Bart Hendricks. That would be my vote.
I'm glad you don't disagree with me then.
Davey Malathon. Inside the 25-yard line, Malathon a senior. Nine fifth-year seniors in this program, Randy. And as I mentioned, they've come through a lot in terms of coaches and coaching changes. The latest being during this particular postseason when Dirk Cutter announced that he and 7 members of his staff were going down to Arizona State to take over that program down there. And they came back to prepare this football team for the bowl game. They faced a worthy opponent here today. It took the Miners a while to get acclimated to the conditions, but they certainly did show well here today at times and making their comeback from deficits of 10 to 14 points. Malathon! Inside the 5. Boy, that senior smelled the end zone, didn't he? Touchdown saving tackle, Weldon Cooks.
What a nice story about Davey Malathon. He was a starter last year, Brock Forsey was a freshman. Forsey really came upon his own in this game, the Humanitarian Bowl last year. Malathong was basically demoted to a backup, a special teams player, but he's really handled it very well. Great character, he's done a nice job, and it's good to see him have a little success here.
So it's first down and goal to go. Time winding down on this one. Malathong. Cut back to the two, maybe the one. Bart Hendricks taking his final snaps under center. The look on the face of the Miners will tell you all. They came here to win, not just to enjoy bowl experience, the first one for the school in 12 years. Came here to win, and they're disappointed, as you would expect.
Boy, but they have got so much to be proud of. Going from the second longest losing streak in the country 2 years ago to the third longest winning streak this year. What a job. And they've got a lot of young players on that team, and they are going to have some success for years to come.
Final snap of the game. Time winds down, and Boise State has won their second consecutive Crucial.com Humanitarian Bowl victory. Dirk Cutter, Gary Nord meet out the 50-yard line. Rocky Perez, congratulations on their great season. The clock had stopped. The officials are winding it. This one is in the books. So again, the final score. Boise State 36, UTEP 23. ESPN has more college football action coming your way at 7:30 p.m. Eastern time tonight. It's the 2000 Insight.com Bowl. The Pittsburgh Panthers and the Iowa State Cyclones from Bank One Ballpark in Phoenix, Arizona. Coming up next, it's ESPN News with Bob Stevens and Bob Halloran. It's been a wonderful day again here in Idaho for this, the fourth annual Crucial.com Humanitarian Bowl. For Jim Barber, Randy Wright, our entire ESPN crew, I'm Wayne Larrabee. This has been a presentation of ESPN, the worldwide leader in sports. For more, log on to ESPN.com. ESPN News is next after these messages. You.
The quarterback failed to make the call, or he failed to make a hot read. One of the two. Miller. Here's on what may close the third quarter. After coming up to take it at the 22. Look out. Welker can do a lot of what Stokes can do, and that is strike fear into the heart of a coverage team. Kelly Hardy brings him down after a return of 34 yards on a punt of 33 yards by Miller. End of the third, 40-14, ECU.
ESPN's 2001 Almanac, a great holiday gift in bookstores now. Whoever said small business human resources was easy? You've got your payroll taxes, your benefits administration,
your W-2s, W-4s, 401ks, workers' comp, employee training, development, recruiting.
No wonder there's no time to grow your business. Why not turn it all over to Administaff, your human resources department for small business? Call 1-800-465-3800. Administaff.
Superstitious? It's a little bit strong. May I do whatever I have to do to help out the team? Let's say you got a tie game, full count. Nobody's on. If I can eat a whole hot dog before the runner gets to first base, then he's coming home. Case of high-scoring games, Rolaid.
Rolaid starts to neutralize acid in less than 10 seconds, getting you back on your game fast.
Nachos, of course, are the key to a great double play.
Rolaid, R-O-L-A-I-D-S, spells relief.
You know that grand slam last week?
danger of sending the wrong signal? Get Selsun Power. Doctors recommend Selsun Blue. So don't send the wrong signal. Get Selsun Power.
Pentium 3 processor. Ever wonder what it's like to be 007?
Get the time.
Certainly. Wrong one. This is not. Oh, God.
Need more practice?
During the third quarter for East Carolina. They start the fourth up 40-14. Dave Barnett, Bill Curry, Mike Wallace. and Michelle Tafoya. If the Astrodome in Houston, the first gallery furniture Houston Bowl. First team, Curry. All alone, spot Darryl Jones up the left side and out of bounds inside the 20. Jones had a 65-yard catch and run for the second Texas Tech touchdown, their biggest play of the night. They have been outgained 429-234. Another night, as we look at our accurate stats, where time of possession is the least instructive stat on the board.
It's amazing to see 52 yards rushing by Texas Tech. They only average 66, so they're almost right on pace for that. It's obviously those passing yards that are killing them.
And Jerry, time to look into the end zone. Will this draw a flag? No, it won't, and King Scobel can't believe it. Reggie Hemphill had him tied up.
It looked like that should have been called. I think they missed one over there. Reggie Hemphill just spun him around, and the ball was most definitely in the air. Just when you need, interference. Yeah. You cannot run into the man when the ball's on its way, and it was definitely a catchable ball. Officials don't miss many like that.
Lucy Williams goes out wide. So goes over the middle and inside the five, all the way to the end zone for the touchdown. Goes Cole Roberts, 17 yards.
And once again, down in scoring territory, Coach Jim Rose decides to blitz young Cliff Kingsbury, who is perfectly coached and aware of the blitz. Times his throw just right. Roberts makes a nice catch and then drags the defender into the end zone, and Tim is wishing he had not gone after him. They have yet to screw up on a blitz.
The extra point. That's at least making a respectable show of itself in the second half. Cole Roberts' father, Donald, played on the most successful Texas Tech team ever, their 10-win season in 1976.
Well, I tell you, when this offense is in sync, it sure does look nice. I mean, they really do a nice job of moving the ball around, and Bill, as you said, they went after him, so it's man-to-man on the tight end with the linebacker. Coverage was there. The ball was just thrown perfectly. Just let him. See the backer in coverage.
And you know, he throws wiffle balls.
Yeah.
That ball was not spiraling.
No.
But it was just in the right place. It was easy to catch. And it doesn't matter if it's pretty. Bobby Lane, who hung out down here in Texas in his life, he didn't throw very pretty balls, but he went to the NFL championships because he threw them to the right place.
I'll tell you what, you can throw them end over end as long as they get there.
See, this kid could have quit. Kingsbury could have hung it up and just said, well, I don't have it tonight. But he's come back, and he's led his team, and that's a great encouragement. It's going to be interesting to see if East Carolina can now come back and answer again as they did last time with the field goal. In fact, they answered with two field goals.
Kingsbury now has some impressive numbers to show for his night. 226 yards, 21 to 34, third touchdown pass. He led the nation in completion, 362.
bowl game regular season.
Can you imagine completing 362 passes in one game?
He'll probably get another 20 throws in tonight, though.
So, a yard deep, bringing it out.
For a minute, you said, look out, here he goes again.
What a football player. He hits that wedge like he's shot out of a cannon. He is absolutely fearless.
I just sit up here and hold my breath. I'm actually holding my breath when he runs. You just wait for him to come out the other end and take it to the house.
Yeah, so many times he does.
He's another guy. He's going over to the Hula Bowl and trying to have some fun over there and impress some pro scouts some more.
He'll impress some pro scouts because everybody needs somebody that will do this and come in on third down and make first down.
Garage 15-25 for 215 yards with a touchdown. Option keepers have been effective for him all night. He scored on a 5-yard run about like that one. Let's go down below to Michelle.
Well, Dave, I don't know if you knew this, but at Texas Tech, there's an old tradition of throwing tortillas onto the field when good things happen, like a touchdown is scored. Now, these have been banned from Texas Tech games, their home games, because the tortillas were thrown in such quantity that it would cover the field and cause interference. But a lot of the fans here today have brought tortillas. They're being thrown around the Astrodome, and they're being cleaned up very promptly as well.
Can Michelle, can you save a couple of those?
Bring them up to go.
I'd be happy to throw
them at Mike.
Thank you.
They'll love it. I look at that position as a tremendous waste of good Mexican food.
Absolutely. Imagine the fajitas you can make out of those things. Are you kidding me? That's wrong.
Mike, is it true when we ask you, our radio people at your show ask you about Christmas Day and how it went with your family, that your response was, it was wonderful because we ate a lot of ribs? Is that what you said?
You know, a full family is a happy family. I mean, is there some kind of rule? Is there a 15-minute rule? Pick those things up. We can still use them. Come on.
Just brush them off.
It's awful. Carpet is on. There's no dirt.
Hey, Mike, I have a question for you.
Yeah.
They've got corn and they've got flour. What do you prefer?
I'll go with the flour, quite honestly.
Flour tortillas, I'll gather as many as I can for you.
I appreciate that.
And a little sauce, a little extra sauce for Michael.
No problem.
But if you have to settle for corn, no problem.
No, I hate those too.
You kidding me?
Second or something's better than nothing.
Benry for gain of one. Second and nine. Pirates is up with Grinder. He needs off that clock. So again on the ground. And a loss. Quick reaction by Lawrence Flugent, whose name we've not had a chance to call too often.
Yeah, I want to go back to something Michelle said that about Garrard and trusting the coaches, how he trusts the coaches in their calls. A big difference here in the offense, we talked about Kingsbury in the Texas Tech offense, he's changing plays at the line of scrimmage, calling out what he sees. Garrard rarely audible. He usually calls what the coaches call. If he audibles, it's usually to a three-step drop and a quick throw. He usually sticks with what the coaches say. That's the trust there, and rarely does he come out of it. So there seems to be a great rapport with he and the coaches.
Three wide. And scrambling on play action and drop. Sack at the 37. Mark Washington comes on a safety blitz. And on the running play on second down, a nice job of the strong safety, Curtis, coming off the corner. Now Mark Washington, the free safety, coming on the safety blitz. Both very well timed and effective to stop this drive. And we said Texas Tech would make a run, and that's exactly what they're doing.
Second sack by the Raider defense tonight.
And hangs one high. And as he took that punt, he hit a knee, and John Norman has to settle for the 35-yard miss. Well, not too often we see a linebacker returning punt. That's how versatile John Norman is.
Can we
furniture announces the incredible Starship sectional on sale right now. It contains double recliners with full chaise pads for that oh-so-comfortable feel when you make yourself comfortable. Overhead fold-down table with cup holders for your drink. A dual two-motor heater and massager to make you even feel better when you sit in that beautiful sectional. Lift-up back with adjustable reading lights for each recliner. Removable, fully upholstered cup holders in each arm. And a full-size inner spring mattress. The Gallery Furniture Starship 2 sectional on sale right now. Gallery saves you money.
Enjoy all the comforts of home before you get there. The Acura TL.
1-800-COLLECT presents Ava Save-A-Lot.
Watch out!
Wow, that was close.
I know. You almost dialed zero to make that collect call.
Well, what should I do?
Just dial 1-800-COLLECT. It saves at least a buck or two.
Wow, that's a lot.
And it's easy to remember.
Yeah, just dial 1-800-COLLECT. Oh, it's a no-brainer.
Watch out!
Collect! I remember!
Going up?
1-800-COLLECT. Save a buck or two.
You wouldn't believe the sale.
I hope you didn't put all those in the credit card.
Yeah, why?
Those interest charges are really going to get us.
Don't worry. I used to use that for the wine card. It's interest-free.
Capital One card, all your purchases would be interest-free until July 2001.
We got to tell Bob and Carol about Capital One.
What did you want to...
Annual Gallery Furniture Houston Bowl in the Astrodome this year and next, before they move next door to still under construction Reliance Stadium. In and out of the hands of King Scoville as Anthony Adams laid into it.
Boy, that was a nice read by Anthony Adams, one of his twins, Anthony and Antoine. We talked to him last night. One of them said, I'm 7 minutes older than the other. I don't remember which one said it.
Antoine is 7 minutes older than Anthony.
Okay, yep.
Sophomore's out of Greenville. Barry to Derek Doris. He got the first Red Raider touchdown. It was the 34 by Greg Saturday night receiver. Plays without an undershirt. How can you do that? How can you have shoulder pads just on top of skin?
Old school football. He's also got knee pads about the size of porters.
He takes his ankles,
cuts up his knee pads. He does not tape his ankles.
He takes his ankles right to his ankle. He doesn't.
No, he doesn't tape them at all.
Oh, he doesn't tape them at all?
He doesn't believe in that tape stuff.
There's Bruce. Nothing there for Francis. Dropped immediately by our man Saturday night.
Yeah, he's making his presence felt now, and his team, just watch his teammates, the way they respond. And this defense needs a lift to get this Texas Tech team that suddenly become hot, slowed up. Nice quick read, feels the blockers, goes beyond them, sure tackle.
Junior out of Garden City Community College in Kansas and Ocean City, New Jersey.
Got a brother that's a quarterback. He says he doesn't tape his ankles either. He plays up to the Northeast. Does Mike Wallace tape his ankles? That's the question to me.
Man. I think they let you go on the field without your ankles taped anymore to coach you.
Sends one to Stokes. Can you cover it any better than Paul McClendon did? Didn't violate the 2-yard halo and knocked him straight backward. No heroics this time for Stokes. 9:47 to go.
What gives broadband broader impact? Texas Instruments Programmable DSP. Technology that allows companies to provide internet access 100 times faster. The hardware and software behind wireless home networks. network. A digital fountain of youth that you can simply reprogram instead of retool and replace. From the world leader in DSP and analog, Texas Instruments.
Alberto, and my inside drug is music.
I've got a dollar on top of each shoe, one for me and one for you. Anybody's dollar that lands in the shoe, and yours if it lands in Florida.
Snowboarding in August, surfing in January, and surfboarding every day in between. Just some of the more adventurous things that the Travel Channel brings. The Travel Channel, bringing there, here.
Ohio State strong-arm Steve Belisari duels with South Carolina's Phil Petty in the Gamecocks. South Carolina versus Ohio State, New Year's Day at 11 on ESPN.
Defense having done its job, back to the Pirate offense with 9:47 to go in the dome. And a 40-21 lead. Drive 16-26, 221 yards. On the ground, Rashawn Burns, double duty, tight end slash fullback. He powers out about 8 yards, tackled by Kevin Curtis. Well, the Texas Longhorns were the last team to win a bowl game in Houston. The last Blue Bonnet Bowl, 1987, big play at Tony Jones, 77-yard touchdown catch to start the scoring. And then a run from the multi-talented Eric Metcalf to give Texas and David McWilliams the bowl win in his first season as the Longhorns head coach, 32-27 over Ironhead Hayward's Pittsburgh team. That was the final Blue Bonnet Bowl. 13 years later, postseason football returns to the Astrodome. And with the new stadium and with a couple of years, some bowl tie-ins between certain conferences and certain games up for grabs, they hope that they can move onward and upward. Dorian Pitts has had a big play night for Texas Tech, and he has the fumble recovery. Art Brown never had control. It was Pitts who wrestled away a fumble recovery in the first half.
Boy, I tell you what, they're just... They just have the slightest bit of breath left. Does Texas Tech, they're just hanging out if they can do something with it. You see him, Pitts just, well, he just dropped the ball. That was a gift for Pitts. He was just coming up on the backside trying to catch it from behind. Ball fell right into his lap. Art Brown just dropped the ball.
Yeah, if he catches it on the dead run, he runs it in the end zone, and this thing gets real interesting. But what's happened is East Carolina has gotten sloppy, and it just lost its edge, and that guy right there knows it very well. He's a little sick in his stomach.
The defenders work at returning turnovers, too. They look for touchdowns. Short yardage on first down, Derek Doris.
Texas Tech team played in the Blue Bonnet Bowl in 76, 11 years before that one. And the Texas game we just saw, they lost to Nebraska 27-24. I played this Astrodome from 85 to 87, started my career here. And Bill, I know you played here in like the 20s.
Was it? That was built in 65.
Oh.
I know you both had fond memories of the original.
I'm not going to honor that question with a response.
Bill played on the dirt spot that was going to be there.
Kingsbury running for his life, and down he goes again. First guy to get there, Jawarren Blair.
Greg LeFevre finished him off.
Greg LeFevre has decided to step up and jack this team up. He's really made an impact on the attitude of the defense. The offense is not playing particularly well right now. The momentum could quickly swing to the guys in the black shirts, and he's almost single-handedly preventing that.
Third and 15. Four targets to pick from. He goes deep up the right side, and it is caught by Baker.
Wow.
Tim Baker had only one catch early in the game, for 4 yards before he holds this one in for 30 against Grover Benton.
It looked like to me he got a little nick when he made that catch in the first quarter.
Right, yep.
And maybe it took a little time to recover and come off a little ankle sprain or a turn. But look at the concentration. This is how you lead the Big 12 in receiving. A sixth sideline at East Carolina for letting this blowout turn into something other than a blowout. If they score here and get the ball back again, we got a real football game.
First and goal from the 4. Ricky Williams. Got back inside. He may pick up a yard.
Either somebody's head or their helmet went rolling. Oh, it was a helmet. Okay.
No head in it. Thank God.
Here again, one of the weaknesses of this offensive thinking is when you get in the red zone, you really need to get in a three-point stance
right.
And knock people back. You just don't do it enough. It's a simple matter of reps. You're not accustomed to a short yardage offense.
You know, the difference there at the end of it, we saw East Carolina do this, and you talked about their old linemen taking it in the end zone. On that last play, you saw 3 Texas Tech offensive linemen basically at the line of scrimmage on their knees, not leading it through. So there is a huge difference. You're absolutely right, Bill.
Well, they're in a two-point.